Okay, it is 2 o'clock Saturday, so it's time to do this live sale. Let me know if you guys can hear me okay. Should be able to. I turned up the mic just a little bit, so I might be louder than normal. I'm gonna check the chat here in a bit, see how we're doing there. So what's up? It's been a while. It's been about like 6 weeks since we did our last live show. So I don't know. I'm kind of out of practice, it seems. We'll see how this goes. So I guess while we wait for folks to trickle in, we can just go over the rules real quick here. So basically how this works is the live sale exists on YouTube and it exists on TidalGardens.com. If you'd like to purchase coral, it's for the United States only. We don't do any international shipping. You just go to TidalGardens.com and then there's like a live sale category which you can navigate to. On the left there, there's like a little blinking red dot, and that takes you to a page where you can watch the video there, but all 200 and something items are listed there for purchase. So to purchase them, you just toss them into your shopping cart just like any other item. So you can mix and match stuff that's already on the site with live sale items. The system doesn't really differentiate. But the live sale items are only going to be there for about 72 hours. Sometimes they're on there a little bit longer because I just couldn't get to removing it. And I don't make a big point to just take stuff down from the website. So sometimes even like Wednesday of next week, it's still around. So anyway, yeah, you can just check out just like normal. Shipping is a flat rate, $39.99. If you're going to be purchasing corals one at a time, which sometimes is recommended because in order to actually check out successfully and get the coral, you have to complete the entire purchasing process. So if you're going to do it coral by coral, just select local pickup / live sale, and that just makes it so that you don't get charged for shipping each time. So once you're all done, make sure that you either have a shipping module or you paid shipping once. If your order is over $250, shipping is free. So yeah, in summary, shipping is either $39.99 or it's free. Or if you're actually picking up, just send me an email and we'll set up an appointment to come get it. All right, I think that pretty much covers how to go about actually purchasing stuff. Another thing that we started to do recently is something called Patreon. It's kind of like I said it in another video, but it's basically like a tip jar for YouTube videos. So part of like the rewards for that is a shout out on this live sale. So I'll just do that real quick right now and then once at the very end. So these people have crossed the big baller $5 threshold. So thank you so much to Kevin Roach, Nate Bowler, Luis Maggs, and Jeff Cunningham. Yeah, so Patreon is completely optional. You don't have to donate anything, but if you wanted to become like a patron or donor just to help support the video efforts for the YouTube channel, you can go to patreon.com/titlegardens. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So we have a whole bunch of corals to go over today. So welcome everyone. We got a few people already. The first coral that we've got going on here is a green toadstool leather. I'm wondering if, like, if you hit it with a flashlight. Oh, I should probably say who also is here helping out. So Robbie right now is the one that's operating the camera, and Michael is the one moderating chat. So if you're chatting, that's who you're talking to. And if I happen to read your message and respond verbally, that's also something. And I just need to make sure that I can actually take a time out to read chat. Sometimes I get all caught up in talking about corals. All right, so toadstool leathers are kind of neat, and we don't usually have a lot of them for sale. We're always trying to to make an effort to propagate these guys. And so this particular frag is maybe like an inch and a half at most, but usually they get purchased way before this size even. And as far as the care tips, they're pretty tolerant to just about every kind of tank condition. So we've seen them in like really brightly lit tanks, in low lit tanks, high flow, low flow. But one good argument for higher flow is that oftentimes they kind of get this waxy film maybe once a month or so. And that's kind of their method of managing like microalgae growth in their skin. So they'll get this waxy coat, retract all their tentacles, and stay that way for a few days. And with a little bit of extra current, that'll blow off and then it'll extend even larger. So sometimes people get worried that their leather kind of has shrunken up and it doesn't look nice. It goes through this periodic thing. All right, next coral, number two. We ship to continental US and Alaska, but there's a little bit of an extra shipping cost to Alaska, and it's not, unfortunately not legal for us to send to Hawaii. So yeah, Alaska, so there's a, if you have to go to, for Alaska shipping, or for Puerto Rico, you have to go to the miscellaneous section, and there's some additional shipping modules there. I think for Alaska it's an additional $20, for Puerto Rico it's an additional $20. And if you wanted something shipped on Friday for delivery Saturday, it's an additional $15. Okay. BJ Nunn, hey Than, I asked you about rainbow A-can placement last time. I put mine lower in light, and they're like a bowl of Fruit Loops now. Lots of color. Good. Good to hear. Any green Montipora up for today? I think there's one or two pieces, Starkey. Okay, so number two, what are we looking at? This is a neon green crown leather. These are an Australian variety. I think that they might be a lobophytum, but when you get large colonies of it, it almost looks like a sarcophyton, but then has like this this ridge, or the edge, has these pronounced spikes on it, essentially. So that's where it kind of gets its name, of a crown leather. So it doesn't look like a regular devil's hand, which is like a lobophytum. It looks kind of like a cross between a sarcophyton in the main part and then a lobophytum at the very edge. It's kind of interesting. And it has like neon green polyps, which is cool. Okay, number three. I was kind of going back and forth as to what this guy actually is. I think it might be a cinnularia, but it doesn't have quite the branchiness of most cinnularia. When I typically see cinnularia, they have very, very thin fingers, but this particular one has very fat, nubby ones. And I'm eating gas station peach rings candy that Robbie brought in, so I'm gonna be a fat kid today during the stream. Okay, let's go on, number four. It's a small little chunk of neon green Nephthia. At one time, these guys were really close to extinction. They were almost put on the endangered species list, but since then, they've really made a huge comeback. For a while, I had these guys, and it took months for them to grow at all, and I was kind of like puzzled by that, because usually in a home aquarium they take off and they grow like, you know, 2 feet long and stuff, but for the longest time this thing just didn't, and then it just figured it out and suddenly we have huge colonies now. Bruce Hansen, I got Girl Scout cookies for the show. That's been a big thing on Facebook. I'm noticing everybody's talking about Girl Scout cookies. I don't know. So in chat, let me know what your favorite Girl Scout cookie is. I'm gonna mess up voting just by saying the correct answer is Thin Mints. All right, number five. Indo Purple Tip Hammer. So these Indonesian hammers are kind of nice in that they grow a lot faster than their Australian cousins, I guess. You can see right at the base there, I don't know if you can focus on that, Robbie, but you can see how it actually forms a tiny little bud right down there. And so they add additional heads very, very quickly. Whereas the Australian varieties, they have to basically separate one polyp to two polyps to three polyps, that sort of thing. So this guy might add five heads suddenly. So it's a much, much faster growing hammer. So if you're satisfied with the color, because oftentimes the Australian guys tend to be more colorful, but this is one of those situations where you have a brightly colored Indonesian hammer that's also a nice fast grower. Thin mints. I have to check on those again. I didn't see any this last time out, but then again, they might have been hiding. I have to take a look. Some of the places we go to have a lot of tanks, and so it's easy just to miss like a rock there. Because like the actual Estriopora rock doesn't really look like a whole lot. You have to kind of pay attention to see whether there's actually hermit crabs in there. Matthias, hey fan, in process of setting up a new 260. That's huge. Debating on constant water changes. Any thoughts on that? Constant water changes are great. I would definitely give that a try. You can even do like 10 gallons a day. That's probably what I would strive for. Kurt Jackson, are you open to the public? Can I shop anytime? It's by appointment, but we're typically pretty flexible. So just get in contact with us and we'll set up a time. All right, let's go on to number six. This is a green Aussie hammer. It might be a little bit bright. Hey Jake, welcome. You're actually not that late, it's like 10 minutes. So, like one time, one of our live sales, the notification from YouTube came out like 2 hours late or something. It was crazy. So like, we had a really, really, really low turnout, and then suddenly like halfway through the live sale, everybody just showed up suddenly. Okay. Going back to that whole constant water change thing, I really like the idea, because if you didn't already know, like the way you do that is you set up two different dosing pumps, one that takes water out of the system and one that puts water in. So you set it all program wise, and so 24 hours a day these pumps are running, taking out a little bit, putting in a little bit. So over the course of a week you might be changing like 70 gallons of water, let's say, if you do 10 gallons a day. And it's a very, very, very low maintenance method of doing it. It's also very gentle on the system. So if we kind of ran out of square footage in the greenhouse here, but if I was able to, I would get like a 1,000 gallon container, mix it all full of salt water, and just like run five controllers and just have it do constant water changes in this place. But that's just me. Let's see. Let's go to the next one here. Number seven. It's a neon green Aussie hammer. So a lot of people tend to like the look of an Australian hammer a little bit more. Oftentimes they do have some really nice punchy colors. It's kind of uncommon for the vast majority of Indonesian hammers to look quite as bright. But then again, there are like one or two like really rare Indonesian hammers that are just like mind-blowing, but they're very, very expensive as well. All right. Number eight. Let's go on. So this is like a hybrid hammer. It has both the green and purple tips. Mr. Cal, anyone know if running two ATI Coral Plus would be good? We did a video kind of highlighting all the different types of ATI lights. So you can do like a search for that, like ATI light comparison. We did a couple color combinations as well as the bulbs individually. And you can kind of see how the different spectrums kind of compare with one another and the appearance of the corals themselves. I'm pretty confident that any bulb that you select from there will grow coral just fine. I think a lot of it is just gonna come down to personal preference on aesthetics. The only bulb that's really, really different out of that bunch is the actinic one, the true actinic, because it goes way deep into like the near ultraviolet range that the other bulbs don't. What? No, those are just like crummy actinics. Crummy coral life ones. So what you're seeing most of these corals under right now are a mix of Blue Plus and Aqua Blue Special. All ATIs. We're doing a lot more with T5s lately. Okay, so let's go to number 9. Done with the hammers. This is a tricolor oleophilia. It's a maize brain. Does feeding hammers every day speed up growth? Lothario, I am not sure. Because, again, we did a couple of different feeding videos where we played around with different types of food just to see what would eat what type of food. And generally speaking, hammer coral oftentimes didn't actually eat anything. They were one of the more trickier corals to feed. So I'm really not sure if it's going to be a fruitful exercise, I guess. You might just end up putting too much food into the water to really make a difference feeding-wise. Also, Robbie, when you're shining the flashlight, try to go like straight down rather than having it hit the background, because when it hits the background, it gets a little, like, it goes right back into the camera, kind of funny. Thank you. All right, let's go to the next thing in a second. All right, so camera's not broken. We're just moving the rig over a little bit. Coulter Schmidt, 60 gallon, should a 10 gallon water change every week? It couldn't hurt. I mean, you could do it once every 2 weeks as well. Sometimes I like to be able to ramp up water changes if I see something going wrong. But just as long as you're consistent. Clint, first timer from UK. Unfortunately, we don't ship to the UK. We're only able to ship to the US. International shipping is a huge ordeal that it involves import or export license from me, which I have. I have an export license. But I think in most CITES countries, you also need an import license on your end. The CITES paperwork is hundreds of dollars per order. I have to physically get these corals to Chicago or New York, which is a Fish and Wildlife field office, and run it through them with all the proper CITES paperwork, and then the cost of the actual international shipping, next day, air. So it's not out of the question that shipping might be somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 plus 12 hours of my time getting it to Chicago. So generally speaking, we don't ship overseas. We've never shipped overseas. Okay. I mean, because people always ask about international shipping, and we would like to someday, but the math is really goofy when it comes to that stuff. Okay. Next up, this is number 10, correct? Okay, sorry. Didn't even move my thing. Number 10. This is a marbled platygyra. Platygyras, they're a large polyp stony, little sensitive. I've seen some of them just kind of degrade suddenly, but it's not too common that happens. But when it does happen, it's kind of inexplicable as to why. But yeah, they can be a little bit touchier than a lot of other brain corals, short of like a Symphilia, which is almost guaranteed to die. Dane Fisher, hello from South Africa. Hello. Is the reef keeping community very large down there? I wonder. Lars, what food do you prefer for corals? You prefer target feeding or just dosing? We make our own seafood here. We used to use a little bit of Rod's food, which is still, I think, a pretty good food. But we started making our own that happens to be very, very heavy in rotifers, and that really makes them all open up, like, insanely. So, yeah, something that's pretty heavy in rotifers seems to have helped out a lot for us. Number 11. It's a smaller green marbled platygyra. What lighting do you give hammers? We have some under LED, we have some under T5. They stay pretty consistent as far as their coloration goes. Yeah, I think you have a lot of leeway to work there. And whoever was asking about hammers, Bruce has had some success with some frozen food there. Okay. Let's go on to number 12. This is a purple and green platygyra. It's a very, very bright neon green channel. Hey, Michael. He needs your help. You guys can talk. Quite a large reefing community in South Africa. Oh, that's cool. Sometimes I have no idea. Like, it's really strange. Oftentimes in big cities here that you might think would have lots of fish stores and stuff like that, there's none. Like in Philadelphia, for example, I guess, like one of my friends or customers was telling me that, there's almost like no activity in Philly. And Philadelphia is a much, much bigger city than where I live right now. And there's like, you know, 5 or 6 stores, all saltwater. All right, next up, number 13. This guy's a little itty-bitty guy. So if you just wanted to try a platygyra out, this is a little cheap way to get into it. What lighting and flow do you keep Astriopora under? We tend to have like medium, if not strong flow for Astriopora. Mainly because the one piece of Astriopora that we have, the nice big piece, has those crabs in it. And so they do a lot of filter feeding. And they really like the rotifers, I've noticed. But as far as lighting, something middle of the road. Right now they're currently under LED, I think. Okay, next up, number 14. This is a yellow scroll coral. Under different lights, this guy's gonna color up pretty differently. He's currently grown under LED right now, and the appearance that he's taken has more of like a purple base, and at night, the base turns almost black. But you can see that it has yellow polyps. Under like a brighter lighting, like metal halide and stuff like that, this coral tends to be almost completely yellow. Slower growing than you might think. It takes about, I don't know, for us about 8 months for it to double in size. Than, do you have any connection with any coral reefing groups in Ohio? I've been wanting to go to shows and things, but I can't find information. There's really two shows in the Northeast Ohio area. There's one that's put on by Lear, which was, I think, just last weekend. And then there's another one, I think, towards the fall by CC. Cleveland Saltwater Enthusiast Association, something like that. There's Cora, which is like the Central Ohio folks down in Columbus. There's some smaller groups like in Dayton and in Cincinnati. But yeah, there's a few here and there. Okay, number 15. This is a Hills Have Eyes chalice. Purple base, little green eyes. And these guys do grow very, very quickly, and they kind of form these large plates. Do you guys have your store open to the public? No, it's by appointment only. But like I said, we are pretty flexible as far as scheduling goes. And thanks, Dan, I'm glad you liked the videos. All right, let's go on to 16. Lunar chalice. Usually these have a little bit more blue in them. This one is predominantly purple. Okay, next up, 17. This is a mean green chalice. Believe it or not, when we first got it, there was no green on this thing. It was almost, wherever you see green, it was almost white. And not that it was bleached white, it was like pastel white. Like it was almost like a, like chalk. As far as like the different shows go, unfortunately we're kind of retired from going to the shows ourselves. It was like, it's just like a ton of work to do it. And I kind of got burnt out from it. So we did like one big show in like Washington, D.C., like MACNA. And then after that, I was like, you know, I think I'll just like staying home. So unfortunately, occasionally we'll like go to one or two of them just to like, you know, to talk to people and to shop around. But actually setting up a booth and everything like that was just crazy amounts of work. So unfortunately, we don't do too much of that anymore. All right. Number 18. And what type of rock? Pukani dry rock. I really haven't. In general, though, if you're just considering just dry rock in general, I like the idea of dry rock more so than I like live rock, just because like I really worry about hitchhikers and stuff like that. Lots and lots of stuff comes on live rock, so both good and bad. And I just think that the avoiding something bad usually outweighs the something good that comes. Mr. D, what's the shipping cost? Shipping cost is a flat rate $39.99, or it's free after $250. Okay, so, oops, forgot to change the overlay. This is an orange fungia plate. He's probably a good 3 inches in diameter, I'm gonna guess. Really nice and bright. Okay, next up, number 19. This is an ultra orange and green plate. This type of plate is kind of interesting because you can actually propagate them. Some of the other plates, like this, I forget exactly which variety. There's like Cycloceras, there's fungi and whatnot. But this variety, the base of it forms like these, almost like these flaky scales, and you can break those and they all regrow. Whereas like another type that's just a straight round circle, when you cut those, they don't really ever regain that circular shape. So this is one of the ones that actually does. After 2:50 p.m., it's free. That's hilarious. Anemone, is it doomed? Depends on what kind of anemone. Let's say about half the anemones that are in this hobby don't do well in captivity. So you have to really be careful as to which types you're buying. Okay, let's move on, number 20. It's a little green helmet fungia. And we have three of these available. Occasionally you see that X3 or X2 or X10. We just have other ones. They basically look like this, so it's not what you see is what you get, but you'll never know which one you got. They look pretty similar. These guys actually have like a little cup shape. So you have to kind of worry, like not worry, but when you're introducing it to your tank, make sure that there isn't like an air bubble stuck in there, because then the flesh will die right there and the whole thing can get infected. So kind of like put them in upside down first and then flip them back over, because yeah, they sometimes can just get that little pocket of air in there. Haitian pink tip. Not really sure. I haven't had one of those in a really, really long time. But generally speaking, a gaping mouth is not a great sign. BJ Nunn, any nice rock flowers in the sale? Not in this one. So the problem with a lot of anemones for this live sale, let's go into number 21 while I talk about this. It's a turquoise tongue coral. The problem with having anemones on a live sale is that they run away. We set up the corals the night before, and guaranteed by the time this show rolls around next afternoon, they're gone, and I'll never find them again. Because some of these tanks are like 240 gallons, they'll just disappear, and probably end up in an overflow or something. So, in the future, what I'll have to do is probably just take like a short video, play the short video behind me, so you're not going to see it live or anything like that. But that is one way that we could sell them and actually at least show some video of the anemones. But right now, unfortunately, no, there's no no rock flowers. Okay, next up, 22. It's a little single polyp of a kryptonite candy cane. Bright green colors, and these guys grow pretty quickly. They divide kind of like those Aussie hammers, where they kind of have a single head and they pinch off into two. But these guys do it pretty quickly. Making me crave some candy now. The candy was not my idea. Somebody else brought it in, and I'm unfortunately eating it all. And I don't need to be eating it. Trust me. you can if I was to choose anything to feed a plate coral, it would probably be like the Fondamarin LPS stuff. I like the sinking pellets for a lot of the LPS that constantly feed like that. I'd give that a go. Any frozen food. I mean, when it comes to plate corals, they're not that particular. So you can feed them just about anything, but the convenience of like a nice pellet food is kind of appealing. Convenience is always appealing, I guess. What's the difference between tongue corals and plate corals and fungia plates? So tongue corals, they grow in like the shape of a tongue. They go like this. Fungias typically stay round, and tongue corals have like multiple mouths. And if you frag them, you can kind of cut them up, and then they grow back long again. Okay, well, let's go to number 23, which is actually just another kryptonite candy cane. Today, any acans? Yes, there's gonna be plenty of acans. Okay. Next up, number 24. Green Duncan coral. This is actually a really, really good deal, because usually we sell this stuff for about like 10-ish dollars per polyp, and I can see that there's like three of them on here. I honestly thought it was like a one, maybe two polyp thing at best, but it might have like four or five just looking at this video here. Massive cactus. Rock flowers are the next craze. Might be. We had posted a really nice one just the other day. I think just yesterday. And I think it sold for a whole bunch within like a couple hours. So there's definitely some demand for those. Okay. By the way, you might notice that the light changes just a little bit. Robbie's got a flashlight that's has some actinic LEDs in it. So that can kind of give you just a little bit of a different look. So, like fluorescence changes, this and that. So, it's always kind of difficult. Even when I'm showing you video live with like a professional cinema camera, sometimes things can get lost in translation. So, whether it be just the type of lighting or what, or it could just be mangled by the camera, it could be mangled by the computer, it could be mangled by YouTube compression, it's challenging. So, we try to give as much, as many different looks as possible. And sorry, Marissa, we can't ship to Canada, only the U.S. All right, moving on, number 26. Oops, sorry, number 25. Getting ahead of myself. It's a smaller green Duncan, again, which has like a bunch of heads that I didn't see. Do you feed your tang anything, or just let it live off algae? No, we pretty much have an algae clip for them every single day. Before, we used to just, you know, feed frozen food, like once a day frozen. And all of our tangs were very, very thin. Nowadays, we have an algae clip for them every day, and they're super fat. So I definitely recommend getting an algae clip. Or if you just have like an algae magnet, we don't actually have algae clips. We have algae magnets. And then for just keeping the glass clean, and we just like clip the nori in there. All right. Let's go to 26. This is a little yellow frog spawn. This is one of those Yayamensis varieties. Okay. Unfortunately, we don't have torches. We have bad luck getting torches to survive in here. Usually they come fresh off of like the importer, and oftentimes they really struggle once they get here. So once in a while we give it a try, but they're so expensive because oftentimes the torches we get are from Australia. They tend to have like a higher price tag, and then on top of that they're very fragile. So it's kind of like double risky there. All right, next up, you can kind of see him peeking through, but it's number 27. This is a neon green frog spawn. Number 28. These guys I love. I'm still a huge fan of Pectinia. And we're always on the lookout for like the super colorful ones. This is like a rainbow variety. And I'm sure that it's not going to show up well just because it's YouTube. But right where it has those like those orange mouths, there's a little light yellow speckle pattern in there as well. So you have like the big, you know, purple ends, you've got that ring of green, you've got that orange in the middle with yellow speckles. It's a really, really dazzling piece. Sometimes they come as a snow-cap variety, where the tips of those spires, they have like white tops. Very, very cool. And there's like a void terror variety that's like a dark, dark purple with bright green eyes. But for the purposes of this sale, there's this guy number 28, and then 29, which is a larger one. So let's go to the next one. Rebecca wants to know what candy you're eating. I'm eating peach rings, the Circle K brand. So this is, you can only get these at the gas station. Now I'm sure that every peach ring is exactly the same as every other peach ring. I don't think there's a huge variety of these things, like gummy bears. Like how different can gummy bears possibly be? Will you be doing A-Can soon? Kinda, yeah, kinda. What lighting and flow for Pectinia? We go moderate on both. So I think that Pectinia, they color up best under T5. But I have seen them under all different types of lighting. And I can see Robbie's face in the reflection. Yeah. You can scoot it back in. Now that, oh, the next ones are big? Okay. How come you guys have so many amazing corals over there? Thanks, I appreciate it, because I'll tell you something funny. When you have to pick out corals for a live sale, we have this greenhouse full of coral, right? And picking out corals is such a chore for us. We look around and we're like, we literally have nothing we can sell. Like nothing at all. And it takes us hours and hours and hours just to like pick these things. And you're like, Jesus, this is embarrassing. Look how bad these look. So I'm glad you like them. All right. We shall move on. Oh yeah, you definitely have to move back for these guys. These are the big ticket items right here. This is a pink speckled acanthophilia. And they're huge. They're like 8 inches at least, 8 to 10 inches, fully extended. Kevin, are there corals which do not need any lighting? Yeah, there's non-photosynthetic corals. And believe me, they are way more difficult than the corals that do require lighting. Non-photosynthetic corals, they have to eat constantly for good health. I've seen like displays that have done them very well. And then I've gone back to, by displays, I mean professional displays at public aquariums. And I'm thinking, wow, that's amazing. And then I come back like a couple years later and all those corals are dead. So it's definitely one of those challenges where you might be talking about like a constant feeding system to get that to work right. Okay. Yeah, so if you're looking for like showpiece type stuff, acanthophilias are very nice. And they're practically bulletproof. They're very, very tough. Okay. 31 is the gold flake acanthophilia. So this guy is a deep purple color, and it's got these bright, bright yellow speckles. And both of these are very, very, very fleshy and large. We had to move the entire camera back, so it's not like, it's a little bit bigger than the hammers and the little leathers at the beginning. These things are literally 20 times that size. So, yeah, like if you can just imagine about that big, it's about half the size of my face in real life. All right. Are we going down one tank? Okay. What's the growth rate on acanthophilia? It's kind of tough for me to say, because they typically don't stay here that long. I have seen gigantic ones, though. And when you see those gigantic ones, they're like 12 to 14 inches in size. And it probably doesn't take them that long to achieve that size as long as they're fed. Pretty consistently, and it's really easy to feed them. As soon as you put food in the water, they open right up. Are acanthophilia fragable? I don't believe so. All right, so let's see. This is we've got like some zoanthids spread out during the sale. We've got like a set here, and then towards the end of the show, we've got a whole bunch. And if you're looking for like the discount bin stuff, it'll be at the very, very, very end of the show. But this guy is the armor of God. Sometimes Zoas and Pallies get kind of confused. In the industry, oftentimes this will be called a Pallyothoa, but I'm pretty sure that it's actually a Zoanthid, because realistically, there's very few real Pallyothoa, I guess. Most of the things that we see, even that are like large polyp stuff, is really just the zoanthid. Okay, moving on, number 33. This is a lunar eclipse. Oftentimes also called a pally, but this is a lot more red than what's typical. Usually only the skirt is red and the main body is kind of purple. What kind of lighting is this under, I wonder? I think it's a mix of LED and T5 in that tank. Okay, next up, number 34. Some green-eyed Zoas. Dave Davis. I believe they're considered Musa now. Not really sure. I don't personally keep track of a lot of the taxonomy changes. It was never that interesting to me, I guess. But a couple of my friends are over in Okinawa doing like classification research on zoanthids and Pallyothoa. They're doing like genetic sequencing and stuff like that. And so they're identifying more and more and more different species and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. Oh, the gallons? We're in the ballpark of 5,000 gallons right now. A little bit more, maybe. Yeah, so Tom, the greenhouse here is constantly changing, so I never know exactly how big or small this place is, but usually hovers around 5,000 gallons. All right, let's go to 35. These are the Oreos. Whatever that light is, it is doing weird stuff. So in person, it doesn't look anything like this. It's usually like that reddish purple that you see is almost like a dark, dark, deep dark purple. And the green in the middle is pretty consistent, but like the reason why it's called an Oreo is it kind of looks like that dark cookie outside and like the white inside. So yeah, for whatever reason, it's not translating on stream. Can acanthophilia regain color after bleaching? Yeah, pretty much anything can, but you kind of have to nurse it back to health because it's losing all of its like zooxanthellae. Do you guys ever plan on doing auction on corals eBay style? Actually on eBay, literally, definitely no. But doing another auction thing, we don't really have it built into our system, but possibly. We haven't really considered it. A lot of people want to sell coral on eBay. I can give you a few reasons not to. So we used to like years ago when we really didn't have better options. But the problem with eBay is that they take a whole bunch of fees, right? Obviously, everybody knows about that. The problem with just these fees is they take it on the listing, they take it on the selling price, but then they did this thing where they wanted more people to offer free shipping. So if you were to charge shipping at all, they charge 10% of whatever you're charging for shipping. And all coral go out like next day air. So every single one of your auctions gets like $4 or $5 or something like that tacked on. So it's entirely possible to sell a coral for like a very, very low amount of money and lose money and actually send out that coral. It's weird. And the other thing is eBay is like super low traffic. So you can go an entire auction and get literally like 6 views. And so you're paying like, you're losing money to not actually get in front of anybody. So yeah, I don't like eBay. Okay. So what number are we on?
36.
Okay. And now we're on... That's 36?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Note to self, these lights aren't doing anything for me.
There's a lot of sun coming.
Is it a lot of sun? Okay. Maybe it's just sunlight. Sunlight's hitting and doing all this crazy stuff. Okay, let's go to number 37. Let's just go through this because it's not cooperating. But this one looks good. This is a creamsicle zoa. That is actually what it looks like in person. But the other ones, nothing going on. Have you ever had to deal with dinos? I'm guessing dinoflagellates, and if so, how did you get rid of it? Are you talking about just like the brown stuff on your glass? I'm not really sure if there's anything that you can do besides just wiping that stuff off and it kind of goes away after a while. But if it's a daily wiping the glass thing, that doesn't ever go away. Not that I know of. Or if you do something, it might be pretty drastic and might have other consequences. Lighting and flow for Cynarina. You're going to want to go medium to low flow, because if you give them too much flow, they're like a big parachute, and their body can get pressed up against their skeleton and stuff. It doesn't look good. As far as lighting, I would go kind of medium on that, but with a preference for some of like the broader spectrum stuff like T5. They tend to color up a lot better under T5 than under LED in my experience. Are there any zoas that fight each other? Not that I've seen. We've kept them all over one another, and it's not been a problem. Next up, number 38. These are Fiji hypercolors. And I'll be perfectly honest, that's a little brighter than they're going to appear in your tank. That's really wonky lighting, but the colors are pretty much correct. It's just like the vibrancy is a little bit much. It's a pretty slick coral, though, don't get me wrong. But that's kind of a radioactive bright color. And by the way, I'm noticing that there's a lot of Germans watching the stream, which is very, very cool, because for the longest time, Germany had weird telecommunications laws where live streams on YouTube were considered like a television broadcast and were blocked. So it's really cool just to start seeing a lot of Germans able to actually at least watch. I mean, sorry guys, you can't purchase anything because we can't ship to Germany, but at least you guys can watch now. Before you couldn't. Okay, next up, 39. These are some rainbow zoas. And there's a little Aptasia in the middle. We'll feed that to a copper band before shipping him out. Dan, do you guys have any black sun corals? No, I don't think so. We struggle a lot with the non-photosynthetics. They just tend to shrivel up and die. We don't feed them enough. Okay, number 40. Lars, off topic, opinions on the new Deadpool. I like that movie a lot. I like the movie a whole lot. I thought it was very funny. The opening, just the opening credits I thought were hilarious. They do a really, really good job of making fun of themselves in a very meta way. It's a lot of fun. It's rated R, and I think that you're going to see a lot of a lot more superhero movies being rated R soon. Oh. Yeah. There's a Coral Magazine article that I had written in the States. That was translated to German, so I don't know if you guys caught that, but I guess in the German equivalent of the Coral Magazine, you can actually read one of my articles. Okay. How do you get rid of Aptasia? It's kind of like an ongoing battle. Copper band butterfly fish do eat them, but generally speaking, you need a ton of them. A ton of Aptasia to keep them fed, because they can eat like 50 a day. Another thing might work is peppermint shrimp or physical removal, which is kind of tough as well. What are the logistics for shipping internationally? Basically, it is such a pain in the butt that unless we're talking like five figures, I won't really consider it. Like, it would be, it involves import-export permits on both ends. It involves CITES treaties and CITES documentation, and I have to ship it all through a Fish and Wildlife field office that gets inspected. And if there's wrong paperwork, the animals get confiscated and destroyed, and I get a $10,000 fine. So unless we're talking a lot of money, I'm probably not going to be shipping overseas. It's an ordeal, believe me. All right, next up, number 41. These are some double rainbows. Any favia? Yeah, there's a few. It's gonna be, I don't know, a good like 30 corals before we see any favia. But yeah, there's gonna be some. Brown hair algae. Not sure what brown hair algae is. I'm usually just used to the green stuff. But when it comes to any nuisance algae, look first at just your water chemistry. A lot of stuff can be solved just by doing additional water changes. And I always recommend doing a lot of water changes. Actually, let's go to the next coral before I get into this topic. But the thing about water changes is it's like when a dentist asks you if you flossed, or somebody asks you when was the last time you worked out. A lot of times it's like, oh, I floss all the time. And you probably floss like once every 4 months, that sort of thing. That's the thing with water changes. Like a lot of times, you know, I ask people like, you know, how often do you do water changes? They're like, oh, we do it every week. And I'm like, I guarantee you, if you did water changes every week, you would not have a hair algae problem. That is impossible. So yeah, actually doing water changes will solve so many problems in this hobby. I would first resort to just trying that, and just see what issues you really have afterwards. Yeah, red slime algae, water changes. There you go. Okay, next up, number 43, some goblin zoas, half of which are closed. Is that the last one in that tank?
Yes.
All right. These guys, you might want to just look on our site as to what they're supposed to look like, but they've got like a nice green center, orange skirt. Can you crack open this door just a little bit, Michael? It's a little toasty in here suddenly. So right now it's snowing weather out here. It's a nice day today, but it's bright and sunny. So what that does is it makes the inside of the greenhouse here like 90 degrees. But outside it's freezing, so we have to kind of like play this little game of opening and closing and opening and closing the doors. Because it's like, oh, too cold, oh, too hot, too cold, too hot. So yeah, and I'm wearing like the sweater thing, and if we leave all the doors closed for like half hour, it'll absolutely get to 90 degrees in here suddenly. Than, do you guys have any worldwide coral bounce in the greenhouse? In the greenhouse, no we don't, but I am getting one from my friend. So technically I have one, also technically I don't have one. And it won't be for sale for a while. I think we're just going to hang on to it for a bit. So this is number 44. It's a pearl bubble. And that is super duper overexposed. Yeah. So I'll have to wait a sec. There we go. Much better. In your experience, is 5% water changes each week enough? Yeah, that'll do it. 5% is plenty. You could do more, 10% even. But 5% is fine. We almost never have bubble corals. That's another coral that, when it comes in, half of it dies. But this one has hung on quite nicely, so. And he's pretty large. And can you guys hear that train? Like, there's a train that just, like, constantly is making noise behind me. So, I apologize if that's all you're hearing. All right. Yeah, that's way better. Looks good. Okay. That guy's about, what, 6 inches it looks like?
Fist size.
Yeah, it's about the size of a big fist. All right. Next up, number 45. It's a rainbow painted trachy. And we have to brighten him up a bit. We call these guys painted trachy because it looks so, almost looks like you take a different colored paint and just like slather it on this thing. And if you could scroll down just a little bit and then hit that part with a flashlight, you can see all the reds and yellows and stuff like that right on that edge. Yeah, it's a completely crazy set of colors on this thing. Zen64, love vodka for the tank. We tried vodka before as it's carbon dosing. It's where you promote certain algae through direct carbon supplementation. So a lot of times people either use vinegar or vodka, or there's like other like commercially made supplements that do this. And then the protein skimmer would then skim out this bacteria. And that's a way to clean your tank, because in addition to taking up this carbon source, they also take in nitrates and phosphates and stuff. So sometimes that can also help strangle out algae because it's taking out that nitrate phosphate issue. We didn't have that much success with it. Like a lot of our corals looked really upset. Next up, number 46. Another rainbow painted trachy. A little bit lighter this one is. So hopefully that answered the whole vodka thing. But yeah, but you're basically doing, look up carbon dosing. And that's what that's all about. It's you're basically trying to filter using bacteria and physically removing the bacteria. Are bubble corals hard to acclimate after shipping? Usually no. Sometimes it can get banged up just a little bit in transit. Number 47, just because they're so large and so delicate. So this is a war paint scully. Somebody was emailing me asking about scullies, so I said, yeah, you know, definitely check out the live sale because we're going to have some discounted here. But these are looking really, really pretty right now. What lights are you guys using in the greenhouse? We use a mix of T5 and LED. And we do use sun, but the sun kind of is counterproductive for some corals. Some don't like the change in seasons and stuff. Okay. Next up, number 48. UV sterilizer will help a lot. So, a lot of people don't use UV sterilizers. They just kind of like fell out of fashion. but it 100% does a good job for certain things. And one of those things is pest control for like fish diseases and stuff. Very effective. I've heard Scolemia were hard to keep alive for long periods of time. Is this true? No, not really. They're actually pretty easy to keep long term. Question about bubble corals. How hard is it to keep them? Not very. As long as you get them in, they're healthy. They're easy to feed. You can even propagate them. And they grow very, very quickly. Yeah, they don't really have any issues, except that they are delicate, and sometimes they can get banged up a little bit. So just, you know, be mindful of that. But otherwise, it's not that difficult to keep them. How much flow? Medium to low, because you don't want to blast them, because they'll just be all retracted, and you don't want to do that. All right, next up, 49. I'll be surprised if this guy doesn't sell. This one is just an amazing specimen. Nice, bright, bright bleeding apple scoli. We've been growing this one under T5 for a long time, and so it has, like, vibrant color. Yeah, you know, scolies, acanthophilia, and to some extent trachees, if you're looking for that signature large polyp stony coral, people generally, a lot of hobbyists gravitate to those particular types. Marissa Sibilla, have you ever propagated a scoli? No, we haven't. It's really risky. Even if they do survive the cutting, oftentimes what you'll end up with is just two semicircles, and they almost never regain that full round shape. And I can tell that people don't like that, because even if you get like a regular scoli, and if it's not really round, it'll have a hard time selling. So a lot of people are like, well, I don't mind if it's kind of like a strange shape. Trust me, the rest of the market clearly has spoken on that issue. They want round scolies. So I don't even bother. Mort Raven 66, y'all should be paying Than all the advice he's giving. You can donate on Patreon. Patreon.com/Tidal Gardens. Become a donor. You'll get a shout out on this show. If you throw down $5, that almost buys you a foot-long sub. They're now $6 at Subway. But that'll get you a shout out on this show. All right, next up, number 50. It's a red sun scoli. You can be cool like these people. Get them shout outs. Kevin Roach, Nate Bowler, Luis Meggs, Jeff Cunningham. Yeah, see? Thank you so much for your patronage. All right. Enough of that. 51. Oh, in a second, you're going to see an elegance coral. Can Phillips T5s get the job done? Probably. White light has a really nice spectrum for growing stuff. It's just that it might not look the best to actually be observing your corals. And yeah, you guys, if you're buying coral, you're obviously supporting the show. So again, no pressure at all. Totally optional. So these guys, I'm gonna guess about 4 or 5 inches. So that one's, the one that you're currently seeing is number 51 there. Let's go to the next one there in the middle, that's 52. They kind of look like they've got purple tips. More of like a cobalt body. Bruce Hansen, any hardware today? No, no hardware today. And then the last of the bunch is a smaller one, more green, pink tips, and he's $50. Massive cactus, what's your ideal lighting setup? I really like the ATI, they're called power modules? Yeah, ATI power module. That's the LED T5 hybrid light that they've got. I've seen one in person, I like the build quality, they're controllable. And in the smaller sizes, even the T5s are dimmable, which is kind of neat. It's Donald Trump. I love your coral sail. Trump 2016, believe. Don't even get me started into politics. Like, I'm a huge political troll, so trust me. If you voted in the last several elections, you and I probably won't agree politically on anything. So anyway, moving on. Number 54. It's Abysmal Worm Rock. A little bit dark, Robbie. So the coral itself is porites, so you kind of have to treat that as you would like any other small polyp stone. You know, give it decent light, that sort of thing. Give it decent flow, and then on top of that, you have these really attractive bismuth worms. Yeah, Quibbly, dimmable T5s, those are real. So you have like full control of both like the LEDs and the T5s as far as intensity goes. They're expensive fixtures, though. They're really expensive. So we can't even have them out here because, number one, it would cost a super fortune. But on top of that, they take a lot of electricity, you know, running both T5s and LEDs.
Somebody asked if elegance
corals are aggressive. Elegance corals are sticky. The thing that they're going to be most aggressive towards are your snails. Snails, for some reason, like to go over there, and they really, 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 really like to kill snails. So I would worry more about snails and other inverts more so than other coral. Okay, we're going to number 55 now. It's a different bismuth worm rock. Believe it or not, Cody, these things ship just fine, these bismuth worm rocks. The biggest issue with them is that even though they look round and smooth, they're actually really sharp somehow, and they cut through bags. So we have to be extra careful when we're bagging them, otherwise they're just going to empty out the entire bag of water. All right, let's go on, number 56. There we go. John, JP, where do you order them? We used to sell them at our sister company, but I've kind of closeted that sister company for a little while. So, I don't know, send me an email. I might be able to get you one. I'm thinking at some point I would like to be able to sell dry goods through Tidal Gardens, but right now I don't know how to separate all the shipping nonsense. Like, if you noticed already, just for even accommodating this live sale, it's kind of weird to figure out all the shipping stuff. You know, is it free shipping? Is it local pickup? Blah, blah, blah. So I don't want to then add even more confusion into the whole mix with having like dry goods on top of that. That's a completely different shipping method and cost. So I'm working on that. Sort of unrelated questions, disease-free fish. Yeah, quarantine, UV, don't overstock. My electricity bill is actually totally manageable, but it's not. If you build a greenhouse system wrong, you'll be paying a lot for electricity. Or any large system. Okay, let's move on. Number 57. Some Blastowelsi. Yeah, actually a lot of places that are this size, let's say between 5,000 gallons, 15,000 gallons in size, the cost for electricity, for heating, all that stuff, it's going to vary greatly depending on how everything is set up. So sometimes people have the idea that's like, oh, I kind of want to do what you did, except I want to do it like way cheaper. So there's two things that are a problem with that. You'll either pay out the nose for utilities because it was just designed in such a way that it doesn't take that into account, or it's not built robust enough to handle the two worst days of the year, where it's like 100 degrees outside and everything just cooks, or it's minus 30 outside and everything freezes. So you run into those two issues when you're trying to build one of these types of buildings. So yeah, it's entirely possible for people to have like gigantic utility bills doing the exact same sort of thing that we're doing here. All right, next up, 58. It's a tricolor Blasto. Got the red rim, purple ring, and then the center is like a bright green. And Walsies can grow very, very quickly. So even though this one has maybe only like 2-3 heads, it'll add additional heads right down at the bottom. In fact, it might already have several babies. 59. This is a Merletti. Usually Merlettis have much smaller polyps. However, this one has polyps almost the same size as a Welsie. Any tips on keeping electricity bill low for a 90-gallon reef? One thing that's about this hobby is that on one hand, it's like super simple, but it's as complicated as you want to make it. So for example, really all you need is good quality water, good quality light, good quality flow. That's it. But how do you achieve those three things? You can spend a king's ransom on that. And what I've really noticed is that there's a lot of products out there to do this hobby, but how many of them are really necessary? And I always kind of look at it as a process of, you build up all this stuff and load it all onto your tank, all of it's consuming electricity, right? But then it's like, start to back off of that. Like, let's say maybe I didn't need that one particular thing. I'm gonna take it off my system and see how far back you can take it and still be successful. And then after a while, I was like, you know what? It looked a little bit better before. I'm gonna reintroduce this certain technology and really kind of tune in on exactly what it is that would make your tank successful based on your particular maintenance schedule and whatnot. Because oftentimes you'll see somebody else's tank and he's got like 10 other devices that you don't have. And he's like, you think you might need those also. Chances are you really don't. So it is that process. So if you want to like be, you know, saving on just about everything, figure out what that balance point is. And you'll be surprised at how little you actually need on an aquarium that's consuming electricity. The only thing that you really can't dodge that easily is the electricity for lighting. That's pretty much it. All right, moving on, 60. After that little rant, this is a blood red Blasto Welsie. You can kind of see the color comparison between this blood red and the previous red that's in a Merletti. Typically the Welsies have much, much, much brighter, more fluorescent coloration. Are you dosing amino acid supplements? No. And if so, do you notice a huge difference in color? No, unfortunately not. But maybe somebody else in chat does. So if somebody's out there that knows, just let Kevin know. Is it Kevon or Kevin? Kevin Mensch? I can never... It's always a bit of an adventure to try to pronounce usernames and just... Because I don't know if it's like if it's somebody's gamer tag or what. I just don't know. Moving on, 61. This is a purple and green Blasto Welsie. The lighting doesn't quite show off just how bright green that center is, but it's... I've come sometimes here later in the evening under just like the full actinic, and I can't even make out the little, like the fine detail of it, because it just looks like a big splot of green, even to my naked eye. Pronounced Kevin. Okay, good to know. I watched Game of Thrones, and I think one of the characters is Kevon Lannister. I think it's actually pronounced not Kevin. Okay, let's go on. 62. I don't know who's asking about A-cans, but here we are. I'm going to go through some really nice ones. And this one you can probably shine the flashlight right into its mouth. Yeah, there we go. So you can see like all the, all that, that marble look in the middle. Whoa, what was that? That was weird. Oh. I see. So, Acanthastria bowerbanki, it's, we have basically three varieties here. Bowerbanki, Echinata, and Lord Howensis. The bowerbankis have the largest polyps. They tend to grow more slowly than the others. Dan, you should get a Twitch channel. I can't argue with that. I should get a Twitch channel. You're right. The problem is I don't play video games. That's probably the only thing. I don't play. I don't play at all. I don't play League. I don't play anything. The last time I played League was literally 2 years ago, probably. I don't play. I don't play. I would totally have a Twitch otherwise. All right. Anyone use the Red Sea Complete Care system? I don't, but one person on my channel did use the Red Sea thing for like carbon dosing. If you look up, I'm blanking on his name, and I was talking to him just yesterday. Will. His name's Will. W-I-L-L. So check out his tank on my channel, and you can kind of see how well his tank has done. Zen 64, I want to play League Within. No, you don't. I am complete garbage. You want to lose? That's how you lose. All right. This coral here is the our Orange Crush Acan Echinata. Might have to make it a little bit brighter in general. These guys are a little dim. There we go. How knowledgeable were you with the hobby when you made it grow? I was probably in the hobby for about 25 years, so probably a lot. Yeah, I don't know if like a lot of people know this, but I actually used to have like an adult job. I used to do like business development / biotech investment, venture capital investment, and commercialization stuff with universities and stuff. You know, had a business degree, had a law degree, and I decided to leave all of that and become like a hermit that sells coral in his backyard. So, yeah, so if you're going to do that, you might want to know a little bit about the hobby. All right, 64, let's move on. This is the rainbow-centered Acan Echinata. Okay, so it has to be a little darker, good. And then the flashlight, I think, will bring out like the oranges and greens in the middle. There we go. Do you guys test for potassium? I do not. There's like a reef chemistry video that we did. I don't think it's on this channel. It might be on the Advanced Reef Aquarium channel, where I talk about trace elements. And it's surprising in what vanishingly small quantities certain things appear. So, stuff like potassium, stuff like iodine, I mean, it's in such small quantities that it's basically not even there at all. So, for a lot of the trace elements, I tend to not test for that. But I know that a lot of these companies are springing up. I think Aquamedic does it. I think Fauna Marin is doing it, and another company. Triton Marine Labs or something. They actually do like, it's not a mass spectroscopy, but it's like a liquid chromatography, I think, where they actually will break down exactly how much of every little element is in your water, and you can kind of then start to make some decisions. I like that better than, you know, a titration test that you get out of a little box. All right, number 65, moving on. UFO Micromusa. And yes, it really is a sprite red. These things are looking absolutely crazy right now. In the summertime, a lot of these corals don't look very good here because I think it has to do with the photo period, and probably because since this is more or less an outdoor structure, come summertime, like a whole bunch of pollen just gets dumped into our tanks, and I think that makes everything unhappy. So a lot of the, if you go back and see like our summertime live shows, the corals might not look as good as they do now, but right now we're in peak colors, so that is the perfect example of like an insanely nice colored Micromusa. Number 66. Slightly smaller one. Ibupressin, first live show, loving this, thank you. Welcome. Okay, 67. This is a rainbow acan lord. Touch to see the colors, I think it's gonna need the flashlight. This one, although it is a rainbow, its color's a little bit more muted compared to some of the others that you'll see later. You def would need RGB for that. RGB. I don't know. Missing the context. All right, moving on. Number 68. A green pinwheel. Lord, how one's this? Have you had to ban anybody yet, Michael? Oh, that's disappointing. Number 69. Let's go ahead. Another rainbow acan lord. This one here actually develops rainbow coloration all the way through its outer edge too. I expect to see like more reds and purples and stuff like that on that outer part of the flesh. Red, green, and blue LED. Oh, okay. Yeah, RGB, red, green, blue. All right. Okay, let's go to number 70. This is a red halo acan lord. Devin, don't ban me, bro. It's funny. I mean, like, we've had, like, the clan jump on stream. They had to get banned. We had ISIS jump on the stream. They had to get banned. Every now and again. All right, next up, 71. This is the red pinwheel acan. Yeah. Everybody's behaving in chat. Which is like the exact opposite of what would happen on a Twitch channel. It's like, who's this old man playing video games? And that'd be like the most PG thing that was said, probably. Alright, 72. This is a red and purple acan lord. Much, much larger colony. This thing probably has over a dozen polyps. What is your opinion on Acro Power Supplement? I've never used it. I have some here, but my acros might be a little bit of a lost cause. They look good like right now and then for a couple months, and then they're gonna completely go downhill come springtime. So I'm not really sure a supplement's gonna do a whole lot for me. But I don't know, some people, because it's like an amino acid supplement, I believe, and some people really like it, but I personally haven't had any experience with it. Next up, 73. Believe it or not, I've never had a nano. So, electric bee cherry. I've never, ever, ever had a nano. Now, the guy that you're chatting with, Michael, he's going to be setting up a nano. And Robbie has like... he's got three nanos working. So all these guys are like, nano. And me, it's like, I just got a 200 and something gallon tank to plug into my 800 some odd other gallon system. So I have no idea when it comes to small tanks. So did the stream actually stop, or was it just like a couple people that couldn't see it? Okay. Yeah, no Hop and Frog today. Okay. Now, I did promise that I wasn't going to like talk too much about Patreon. So this is not me fishing for more money. Okay? Buy corals. That's my fishing for money. So one of the perks that I have, in Patreon, you have to set up goals and milestones. And it's like, if you hit this milestone, you'll do something, right? And usually it's like, oh, if I hit like a certain milestone, I'll buy a piece of equipment that'll help my videos out, something like that. But my first milestone has nothing to do with that. If we get to like $100, I promise to go buy all the stuff I need to make absinthe here. And I'll get like the entire, like, you know, like the ice water fountain, get the spoons and everything, the sugar spoon, and I'll do absinthe during a live sale on stream. So help me help you guys. Help me help you. All right, what number are we on?
73.
All right. and actually, it won't be just me. Everybody here will drink absinthe. It'll be wonderful. Maybe. We'll see. All right. 73 is a living lava chalice, which you're seeing here. Number 74 is a pink stripe chalice. I'm definitely digging the coloration right now. All of our corals are really pretty much spot on right now. So, yeah, if you didn't already know, absinthe is like an alcoholic drink that is, it's supposed to be extremely strong and possibly psychotropic. But I think that it might have been just improperly made absinthe when stuff was going on. But it's like, it's something to do with like, you know, chasing a green fairy or something like that. So I've heard things about it. G Cunningham, help Than find the fairy, join Patreon. There you go. Lars, a few years ago you posted a video of pink carp anemone. I haven't seen it anywhere else. Is there a chance of one like it ever being sold? Funny you mention that. I saw a couple at my importer, and he wasn't willing to sell either of them to me. So there's that. They're really expensive, like really, really, really expensive. Retail level, expect to spend about $600 to $700, something like that. They're a lot of money. And that's even if like I wanted to buy it, like they weren't even for sale. It's crazy. All right, 75. Golden Eye Chalice. Eric Rodriguez, I used to keep 6 clams in the 20 gallon. They were doing great. We don't do clams very well here at all. I'm gonna give it one more go, but we kind of stink at it. Okay, 76. Let's go ahead. This is a red stripe chalice. Purple base, red stripes. Anop Lok, first time to the live show. Welcome. Everything looks amazing. Just as a reference, how big are the frag plugs? These guys are probably one inch frag plugs that you're seeing currently. So they vary in size from like 3/4 to 1 inch. Because we have different sizes. Are you still planning on filming something on the wholesale aspect of the industry? Thinking about it. That side of the business hobby remains absolutely shrouded in mystery to me. it's a lot less glamorous than you might imagine. But yeah, usually it's because like the wholesale guy, that I talk to, they're usually like way too busy to sit down for a video. That's the biggest problem. What lighting do you keep your chalices in? A lot of T5. A lot of the LPS that tend to shift color a lot, like chalices, A-cans, that sort of thing, benefit from T5. Okay, 77. I hesitate to say yes, but then again, other people have done it successfully. I think that Tridacna clams, like Maximas, Crocias, that sort of thing, when they get older, it's really about how much light you can give them. So my concern is, will you be able to provide it the light that it needs without cooking the 20-gallon tank? Okay, number 78, Hollywood Stunner. This guy here might have been kept in extremely low light because the base is practically purple, whereas usually under brighter light, the entire thing is green. Marissa, because you're in a greenhouse, have your corals ever spawned from time to time? Yes, but I've only seen it happen a couple of times because I'm almost never here in the evenings. But one time I did come in the morning and I saw like eggs coming out of like a frog spawn once. And there's a video on my channel of one time when I just had some friends over and they just wanted to shoot the greenhouse at night. I'm like, cool. We went in and one of the tanks had like, it was completely cloudy. You couldn't see an inch into the tank. It looked like milk. And it was at a time when we had like a bunch of 30-gallon tanks and every other tank was completely clear. Just this one tank was just looked like milk. And it was because it was a mini maxi tank and they all broadcast spawned at the same time. And I would never have seen that normally because by morning it was all cleared up. All right, 79. Mystery Chalice. This is one of my favorite chalices. We've been growing this guy forever. Let's see. Awesome corals. They're looking super healthy. I am really, really, really hoping that we can, that our internet service provider upgrades their system so I could broadcast this in higher quality to you guys. Because right now the big bottleneck is just my ability to upload a lot of data stream. Like we have the most expensive internet package, and I can barely send out like 720p video, whereas like my actual system here could send out a much, 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 much better picture. So hopefully, fingers crossed, in the next few months here, I heard rumors that they're gonna update something, and as soon as they actually do update, they're gonna get all my money. All right, next up, 80. This is a Midnight Princess Phyvites. Depends on what that starfish is. Whenever I had starfish, I didn't feed, but then again, I don't know if I had the best success with them either. They lasted a long time. Like, I had blue linkias that lasted a long time, but eventually they either all got sold or I think a couple of them died. So I kind of don't know. If you know what they eat, that'd be great. But a lot of big starfish, they eat, actually eat coral and stuff, so have to watch out for that. Number 81, this is a Dragon Soul Favia. Favia tend to have larger polyps than Phyvites, and they grow way more slowly. Yeah, you can see just a fluorescence when it gets hit with like LED, big difference. Highly fluorescent greens. Okay, let's move on. Number 82. This is the Mummy Eye Favia. Jim White, what's a good intensity percentage for my Kessels over LPS? You're going to have to kind of experiment with that just a little bit based on what your corals are already acclimated to. The 360 is pretty bright, though. Like, I wouldn't venture above 60%, but that's just me. I tend to keep a lot of my stuff under a lot lower light. Next up, 83. This is a violet and green Favites. He's a little bit dim right now, so let's see if we can brighten that up. There we go. A little better. How difficult are those Favia? They're not really difficult. I'd say pretty much middle of the road as far as care goes. They're not particularly sensitive, don't really need any kind of special care. Are damsels for beginners or not? Well, damsels are pretty tough fish. They're mean. And some of them grow really, really, really big. So it kind of depends on what your appetite is for that. But I tend to not like fish that fight with other fish a lot, and damsels can sometimes do that. On the bright side, though, damsels, in addition to being like really easy to keep, they sometimes eat certain pests. Like sometimes they eat flatworms and stuff like that. So there are some benefits to having them. Okay, next up, 84. This is scarlet and gray Favites. What's your opinion on Chinese LEDs like Mars Aqua? I don't like Chinese LEDs. Well, okay, technically, almost every LED is made in China, but like the actual LED fixtures that I've seen tend to have like pretty shoddy construction, and when you get shoddy construction and LED, you have like premature failure of the fixture a lot of times. So LEDs themselves might last a super long time, but the assembly and stuff is where it all goes wrong, and then so you end up getting like drivers that just fry and stuff like that. So not a huge fan. Next up, 85. This is a Dayglow Favites, which I don't know if it's going to show up on stream that well, but these guys are pretty crazy. They've got like all types of speckles, like mini, like micro speckles of like yellow and stuff like that. So let's see if hitting up the light helps. Yeah. When it comes to like feeding Favia, they're not quite as aggressive feeders as a lot of other corals are, but they do open up to feed. Mysis is a good option, also rotifers. I think they really react well to rotifers. Okay, next up, let's go to 86. I actually haven't used that type of filter media in a really long time. In fact, I don't think we do any chemical filtration of any kind. We don't run carbon or anything. So I think that if it's working for you right now, go ahead and keep doing it. But generally speaking, how necessary it is, it's one of those things. It's like it's really, really easy to add more things. It's a lot harder to take away stuff. So a lot of chemical filtration. We've never run GFO, for example, granular ferric oxide for phosphate control. Never have done it. So yeah, it's just a matter of like figuring out what works best for you in those types of situations. So if I can remove a reactor from my system, I'd like to do that. Yeah, this is some type of acropora. I'm not really sure what kind it is. It's a pretty small piece. And he's doing pretty well. So. Live rotifers? No, we just get the frozen stuff. You can get them in frozen packs. Okay, next up, 87. Cesar Muniz. I'm sorry, I'm like butchering your name. I'm having trouble making my powder blue tang eat dried seaweed. Any suggestions? I'd continue to offer it every day, But if he's already eating other foods, don't worry about it. He'll figure it out. Keep offering it. Zuha, any plates on this live sale? We've actually already done the plates. Don't know what numbers they would be. 20s? 18, yeah. So I think you're actually able to scrub back in the timeline. And right around 18. There's some Zoas and stuff like that later on that you might be seeing that are under 20 here and there. There's definitely some $10 stuff here and there. It's gonna be mostly Zoas though. I don't know about like leathers and stuff. I don't think so, but maybe I could be wrong. I forget. There's 200 corals. I don't remember all the prices. Okay, number 87. Skipping around too much. That is 87? Okay. Okay. So then go on to 88 then. This is a smaller blueberry acropora. Well, there's an under 20 thing, but it's not a softie. It's an acropora. Little tiny guy though. So acropora, if you don't already know, are one of the more challenging corals in the hobby. In addition to needing a lot of light, a lot of flow, rock solid water chemistry, they tend to be sensitive on top of that, and are susceptible to certain parasites. So they've got a lot of inherent challenges in keeping them, but a lot of people that are really into SPS pretty much get into SPS mainly for acropora. So once they get into like larger colonies, they like the staghorn type corals and stuff like that. All right, next up, number 90. Is this 89 or 90? 89. Getting ahead of myself. This is an acropora taraki, kind of like the bottle brush variety. Okay, number 90, moving on. This is like a tiny, itty-bitty piece of Acropora tenuis. Really tiny. So if you just wanted to get something and just give it a try as far as the Acroporas go, start with something tiny. What's your opinion on live rock versus dry rock when starting a new reef tank? I'm 100% in dry rock country. I don't even want to take the risk of introducing pests, which are almost guaranteed to be introduced anyway, but I'd rather make an effort to not have that happen. 91. The ice blue acropora. Looks a little purple under this light, but we'll see what the flashlight does. A little bit more blue. Are there SPS corals that can go into a softy 20-gallon tank? Probably not the best idea, for the simple fact that you might run into like chemical warfare issues. But if there was anything, you might want to try like a Passiflora perhaps, that tends to be a little bit more beefy. You did a video on easy SPS coral on your YouTube channel. All these SPS not in that category? Correct. These are definitely not in that category. Acropora are the hardest. Alright, next up, 92. This is a pink dragon. So you might have heard like red dragon, yellow dragon. This is kind of like the red dragon, but it's a little bit lighter. How long does it normally take before coralline algae starts to grow when you use dry rock? It'll grow. It really depends on water chemistry more than anything else, but if your water chemistry is spot on, it'll be your rock will be purple before you even remembered that it was white. That's how fast it'll be. All right, next up, 93, Icefire Echinata. This is an Acropora, Icefire Acropora Echinata. We're going to be getting into the easier stuff. So we're almost done with the acroporas. We just got a few left to go over. Vivid Chams, what have we gone through so far? Lots of stuff. Some LPS, some brain corals, some acans, all the euphilia, a few zoanthids, plate corals, that sort of thing. You can scrub back and forth through the timeline. Does it take longer to cycle your tank? Probably not. Probably roughly the same. Okay, next up, 94. Smaller piece of ice fire echinata. Any Hawkins? No. The closest thing is that Taraki. They're very, very similar in appearance to a Hawkins echinata. Do you feed the SPS? Not intentionally, but I've noticed them really react again to that rotifer stuff. 95. Yeah, so you can see the difference. It's not exactly like a Hawkins echinata, but it has the same coloration. And there's a fish. Yeah, but this guy's actually doing really well. It's kind of tough to see the base, but he's encrusted down onto the base about a half inch spread. Yeah, I can't really see it, but it's all right. Take my word for it. He's growing on there really nicely. Right, let's move on. 96. This is a blue-tipped acropora. Wonder when we're going to pull into a rest area. Probably item number 109. Okay, let's go on to 97. This is a purple bonsai acro. So you'll notice that this purple bonsai is a whole lot of green bonsai. The base of these guys gets to be like a nice deep purple once it starts to get growing. Yeah, a little better there. At night, these things are spectacular because that purple base doesn't fluoresce, but the green does. So it looks like this green and black coral almost. Hey Than, what ATO do you guys use in the greenhouse? Believe it or not, we do all the top-offs manually. There's no automatic top-off. There's actually not a whole lot of automated anything. Like the only thing that's really automatic are like circulation fans and stuff like that for like air movement. And just like heaters and stuff like that. But as far as like adding in and moving water around, even our lights, a lot of our lights aren't programmed. I started a 40 breeder with dry rock 8 months ago, so far no pests. Hate to be that negative Nancy, but you're gonna get them eventually. Pests are just one of those things that, like, if you've played this game long enough, you're gonna get something. All right, 98. But yeah, it's not important that you get the pests. It's just that, you know, you make the effort to try to prevent it as much as possible, which is good. Start with dry rock. 98. Itty bitty Oregon tort. Probably my favorite acro. And yes, it's expensive. I don't really care if it sells or not. I just want to keep them. They sell too fast. Like, we frag them up into these, literally these little half-inch guys. And people will say, hey, how much for that little one? I'm like, man. Like, you'd think that they're like unsellably small, but no, people want them. And so we only have like a few here and there. All right, let's get into some of the easier stuff. Like Stylophora. Are bonsai called bonsai because they're a smaller grower? No. I don't think there's any rhyme or reason to why anything is called anything in this hobby anymore. I'm not big on naming corals. And it's because there really is not a whole lot of rhyme or reason to stuff. It's like, oh, why is that named butt muncher Zoas. Who thought that was a good idea? I have remedied snails right now. They're driving me nuts. Yeah, physical removal. We have to take them out one at a time. Electric beach area. Where can I get dry rock for relatively cheap? My LFS sells it for $6 per pound, which is crazy. Here's what you do. You buy it off of somebody that's taking down their tank. In fact, that's where you should always get rock. I'm sure I'm like totally like blocking up all types of stores that are trying to sell rock. Sorry, guys. But a lot of people are taking down their tank, especially in a couple months here when spring comes. And there's like a mass exodus from this hobby. That's when you should be shopping for used stuff, like rock or equipment. That's like the perfect time, because as soon as it's warm enough to start mowing your grass, a whole bunch of people stop doing this hobby. So if you can hold off spending spree wise equipment on equipment and upgrades and like, you know, glass tanks, whatever, that's the time. Okay, 100, number 100. What's the most expensive marine animal that Than has ever bought? Probably that bounce mushroom that I got from Nathan. That's a lot of money. Wait, but is that the most I've ever spent? Let me think about that. Yeah, probably. Probably. It's a bunch of money. It's funny, so I made that video about the most expensive coral in the world, and I would guess that about 60 to 70% of the comments, at least, hate that thing. And I completely understand. I mean, it is a totally polarizing coral, but people still shell out so much money for those. Looks like, Jeff Cunningham probably snagged that Oregon tort. Somebody did. All right, so what number are we on? 101. Neon green stylo. Again, these are all beginner friendly. Beginner SPS friendly. They're not the easiest things in the world, but compared to other SPS, they are super easy. All right. What? Yeah, I've been eating them. Okay, next 102. It's a tiny little neon green stylo. So, what's the most expensive Zoa right now? I don't even know. I don't know. I'm sure there's some really super pricey ones. Like Zoanthids right now, it's just not their time. There was a time when everything was like $100 a polyp, but I think right now, like, a lot of interest is still in chalices and in mushrooms now more than they are into Zoas. But at some point, Zoas are going to come roaring back, and people are going to be spending crazy amounts on Zoas. Okay, next up, 103. It's a purple stylophora. All right, let's see, 104. Like a little itty-bitty bird's nest. These things grow so quickly that when we start propagating them, oftentimes they will grow to a size that's too big for us to sell, because we need to be able to package them up and ship them. And so they need to be within like a certain size range. And oftentimes they will exceed that size range before we can actually sell them, so we have to propagate them down again. So we end up having like tons and tons of these guys. All right, next up, 105. This is a Panape bird's nest. So these guys are a little bit interesting in how they color up. So under super bright light, they are pink. Under lower light, they develop purples and yellows and greens and everything in between. So depending on your lighting and placement, this coral can be completely different. Okay, next up, 106. It's a bird of paradise. This is probably my favorite of the Seriatoporas. It's almost break time, guys. Bless you. 107. This is the pink bird. Most of the time I would say that the bird sets don't need a lot of bright light, but these guys, in order to maintain that nice bright pink, they absolutely do. Otherwise they get a little bit dusky looking. Yeah, we have walking dendros. They might be on the site. Okay, 108. Green Postulopora. What is the first coral a beginner reefer should buy? If you're really, really conservative, you can consider like stuff like leathers. They tend to be very hardy. Mushrooms, most mushrooms. Some mushrooms are a little bit sensitive, like Recordia yumas. But most mushrooms are very beginner friendly as well. And like you can get a lot of different colors and stuff. Zoanthids aren't bad either. So between mushrooms and zoanthids, you can pretty much find any color combination you like. Okay. And lastly for this set, we have 109. Is the pink Postulopora. Oh, oops. Let's see. Thanks, Eric the Fourth. Appreciate it. Okay, so we're gonna take. Oh yeah, never mind. Never mind. Keep going. Eric, keep going. I'm dumb. So just for the people that are new, I know that we have a lot of new viewers for the show. This is how that live sale works. If you wanted to make a purchase, you can go to TidalGardens.com. On the left navigation, you'll see a little blinking red dot for the live sale. And that'll take you to a video of the live sale, as well as, you know, whatever corals are remaining. We've gone through 109 of the 205 that we're going to be doing today. And these things will be available for the next 72 hours. Probably going to be a little bit more than 72 hours, just because if I have a particularly busy week, I don't spend time to delete all these guys. So anyway, for sure. So you'll have a 72-hour window of opportunity to purchase anything that you see here. Some of them have duplicate items, so you might not get exactly what you saw, but if it says, like, for example, that last one was like a pink Postulopora times however many, they're basically going to look just like that one. So the way that shipping works is that if your total is under $250, shipping is $39.99. So just make sure that like you've paid for shipping once, and just once. So if you made a whole bunch of separate purchases, like you wanted five different corals, just make sure that the shipping is included into one of those orders, or purchase a shipping module, whatever. You can select local pickup live sales so you don't get charged shipping over and over and over again. If you happen to get charged shipping over and over and over again, don't worry, we refund that all the time. Somebody, every single live sale does that, or sometimes two or three people, it doesn't matter. We'll go ahead and refund you for that. And let's see. Yeah, the reason why people do that is because to actually get the coral, you can't just put it into your shopping cart, you actually have to check out with it. So multiple orders, perfectly acceptable. And we're going to be doing most of our shipping Monday and Tuesday. Like right now, believe it or not, before we even started the live sale, we had a bunch of stuff shipping out on Monday. And we can only physically ship out so many corals before we straight up run out of time. So we'll try to get as many people in on Monday as possible. Otherwise, Tuesday. And some people need specific shipping days. Just email me. We can put that on the shipping calendar. No problem. So, anyway. I didn't need a break. I was just here talking about the rules. Alright, so what number are we on? 110? I think we're on 110. No, 110. I misclicked. So this is the green plating, Monty. So Michael, you want to be a little bit over to the right a bit? Yeah, there you go. A little bit more even. Yeah, there we go. Perfect. So we did a quick change of cameraman. So now in chat, you're now speaking to Robbie, and Michael's now on camera. It's stuffy now. I don't know what's up. Okay, so these are a small set of plating Montipora. These guys are the ones that form like the flat discs. 111, let's move on. This is an orange plating. Super bright, and in particular this orange variety is very, very, very fast growing. So you can have a pretty sizable showpiece within a year. Now we switch up the cameraman at halftime. Get everybody some experience behind the rig. Next up, 112. It's a purple plating, Monty. Even amongst all these different... So before, I guess it within the hobby, people would always refer to plating Montipora as Montipora capricornis. That was kind of like the scientific name. It turns out there's like probably 50 different types of plating Montipora. And Capricornus being one of them, and chances are whatever you were calling a Montipora Capricornus wasn't a Montipora Capricornus. So, anyway, you can just tell based on the three that you've seen so far that all three are pretty different in both color and texture. And all three are plating, and at different times they were probably all called a Capricornus. Anyway. I haven't been reading chat for a while. Okay, so the X3, what does that mean? What that means is there's three of them available. So, like, if when you actually go to the Tidal Gardens website, it'll say quantity 3 rather than just like 1. All right, so next up, red plating Monty. Aaron Josephson, how far from Cleveland are you? About 25 minutes. Straight down 77. Hello from Germany. Welcome. Large German contingent on the stream today. All right. Next up, 114. This is our orange and purple Leptastria. So Leptastria are kind of interesting. They're kind of a relative newcomer to the hobby. Before like a year and a half ago or something, I've never seen any. And suddenly there's all different types of varieties showing up. They don't really require any special care that I've seen. I mean, we just keep a medium everything. In some cases, even low light, and they seem to do fine. And if you missed the first part of my description of what's going on, occasionally what we do is we have like a little LED flashlight for some actinic, and we shine it on the corals from time to time just to give you guys a different look. because it is really difficult to show exactly what something looks like in person, online obviously, and lighting plays like a big role in that. So we try to give you a couple different looks when possible. Reef Aqua 36, are people allowed in the greenhouse to look around and buy coral? Yes, by appointment. We don't have like open hours, but we can schedule something. Next up, 115. This is just the straight orange Leptastria. Okay, next up, this is kind of an interesting coral. It's a blue Pavona. Like, I honestly didn't even know what the heck this was for like the longest time. But this guy here is totally out of focus. Still out of focus. There we go. Much better. Much, much better. Yeah, so if you're familiar with Pavona, usually they're green. We have a purple variety that's like that's very, very violet. And then this guy is kind of like a sky blue. So he's very different than the other stuff that we have. And we have like a nice orange one too, which we'll see in a bit. All right, next up, number 117. This is the green Pavona. And the lighting makes it look very purple, but it's definitely has like has a green fluorescence to it. Any more plating Montipora? No, I think that was it. Not sure if we even have any neon green plating ones right now. We might, but there might be like microscopically tiny. Is a Leptastria like a Blasto? No, not really. All right, next up, 118. This is a Free Care Pavona. I'm a big fan of these guys because they have like this magenta base and bright green tips. And Pavona are very, very easy and fast growing. Hello from New Zealand. I definitely want to visit New Zealand at some point. It's just so far from here. It's like a 20-something hour plane ride. Oh. But it's on my bucket list. One of the places I definitely want to check out. Next up, 120 is an ultra lep. No, wait, no. 119. I messed up. Again. Last of the Pavona. Orange Pavona. Probably one of my favorites too. Do I have a personal tank at home? I don't. It's one of those things that's just not missing from my life. I have cats though. I'm like a crazy cat lady. Next up, 120, the Ultra Leptoceras. We've got four different types of Leptoceras. This Ultra one has a lot more green in it than the other varieties do. Then I should say that the Jack-O-Lanterns do. The Jack-O-Lanterns tend to have like really, really small yellow eyes. Whereas this one, the green extends almost all the way to the rim. Next up is that ultra, or that jack-o'-lantern number 121. You can see how the little eyes are much smaller. They're slightly different color. This is a little bit more of like a yellowish green. Leptoceras at one time used to be very, very, very expensive because nobody's seen anything quite like them. They have like a almost like a metallic appearance to them, which is kind of unique. But it turns out that they're very fast growing, so they've dropped down in price considerably. And I kind of expect that over time they're going to get even less and less expensive because they are one of the fastest growing and one of the most adaptable corals I've seen. All right, moving on, 122 is the green Spartan Leptoceras. So, in general, Leptosiris, I've kept them in like super low light. I've kept them in medium lighting. I've kept them in all different types of flow. They really don't seem that particular. And they're really consistent in their coloration. So I haven't even noticed any kind of morphological differences. They're not particularly aggressive. Haven't really tried feeding them directly. They don't seem to be too responsive to that, I guess. I mean, they're really pretty easy to keep as far as stony corals go. Next up, 123. The last Leptosiris we have is the golden Leptosiris. These guys have none of that green coloration at all. And so that 5X means that there's five available at $25. Yeah, Reef Aqua, a 36G. I'm not really sure what the Leptosiruses eat. I really haven't paid attention when we were feeding. They might grab like really, really, really small particles out of the water, but I'm not really sure. I guess we don't make a special effort to try to feed them, I guess. Next up, we've got 124, which is a purple sand dollar Montipora. So we've gone over some plating Montiporas. These guys are encrusting varieties. So they kind of will go with the contour of the ground that they're covering. Occasionally, like certain varieties will then grow up from there, but not necessarily branch, but they'll kind of develop like their own different texture, their own different topography. But yeah, if you're looking for something just to cover rock, this type of Montipora I think would look very nice. Than, what causes my turquoise acrode to look brown at times? Very likely lighting. I'd look at lighting first. It's almost always the culprit. After that, you're looking at water chemistry. Next up, 125. 125 is the Superman Monty. This is like a tiny itty bitty frag. So Supermans have like the red polyps and like kind of the bluish base. And yeah, I was eating peach rings. I ate them all. Now I'm on to orange slices. Also from the gas station. $126 in a second. It's going to be a Sunset Monty when we get there. I can tell that the days are getting a lot longer because earlier in the year, right around like right around this time, it would be getting pretty dark. So the sun stays out until what, almost 6 o'clock nowadays? It stays pretty bright. Caesar, what do you think about, is it Caesar, Caesar? What do you think about radium bulbs? I really like them. I like the 20K 400 watt halides. Hello from Spain, hello back. Zen 64, someone needs to send Than a fruit basket for his shows. You're not kidding. Like, I'm trying to eat better because I think right now I'm like the heaviest I've ever been. And I started to, so one of the guys that helps out here part-time, he's a personal trainer. And so I started to working out with him, you know, like once a week. And it's pathetic, like how far off I am from my athletic peak. It's like complete disaster. So like my left arm right now, I worked out on Thursday, so it's Saturday now. I have a hard time even bending my arm because the tricep is like so sore that I can't even like stretch it all the way. It's pathetic. And if you heard what I did to get that sore, you'd laugh, just laugh and laugh and laugh. It's pathetic. All right, So 126 is the sunset. We were looking at it the whole time and never hit the button. I'm sorry, guys. Got carried away. Talk about my extreme weightlifting stories. All 20 pounds. All right, next up, 127. This is Scarlet Montipora. All right, 128. It's the Purple Haze Monty. So it's the Purple Haze is kind of neat. We haven't sold one in a long time because they've been really small until now. And this one here is actually really small. But I thought we had lost all of ours for a while there. They're kind of a combination of purple and fuchsia, which is neat. What's the difference between plating and scrolling Montys? It's just a variety. I mean, they both form plates. Some of them just have these plates that kind of like curl up onto themselves again. And a lot of it actually depends on flow. Like, you can get different types of growth pattern just based on flow and lighting. And Brooke, yeah, you missed the elegances. They were number... good 50-ish. Yeah. All right, next up, 129 is a small little Montipora setosa. These are always kind of cute because they have very widely spaced polyps. So as you saw on the encrusting varieties, like how densely packed full of polyps they were, this is very sparsely polyped, I guess. And setosa are a branching variety. Okay, let's see. Next up, we're basically done with Montipora, and we're moving on to some of the softies. So this guy is a Blue Sympodium. So Sympodium is a very fast grower. We just had this little nub hanging out, so we just thought we'd just, you know, toss it onto the live sale. But it is one of the few soft corals that's blue, and it stays like a vibrant blue. It doesn't really fluoresce a lot, but it's definitely something that can cover large swaths of the tank. It kind of sends down like a mat. Where's Miss Saltwater today? She's probably sleeping right now. She got back. I'm so sore. She got back to England fairly recently, I think like yesterday. So she's probably like super duper jet lagged. But she's with us in spirit. You have to, or I was gonna do something like, we have to pour one out for our dead homies. But no, she's perfectly fine, just sleeping. All right, next up, 131. This is a wintergreen pipe organ. So pipe organ, they're called pipe organs because they kind of have this red skeleton-like base, and the red skeleton almost looks like individual pipe organs. And so if the thing is doing well, you don't ever see its namesake. Next up is what we call a purple pipe organ. It's got these... in person, it looks more white than purple, but always on camera, it appears more purple. All right, next up, 133. It's a green cabbage. Yeah, so somebody was asking earlier if there was some inexpensive, low-cost soft corals and stuff like that under $20. This one's a pretty good choice. And then for people asking about kind of like hardy beginner type corals, you really can't go wrong with leathers. You really can't go wrong with like most zoas and pallies. Most of those guys are pretty tough. mushrooms, which we're going to be getting into all of those like shortly here. So pretty much from this point forward, there's going to be a lot of selection if you just wanted to get started into the hobby. A lot of very forgiving stuff. All right, next, 134, are some green clove polyps, which I misspelled, so let me fix that real quick. Green clove polyps. Just a few, there's probably only like three or four on there, but that's one of those corals that does spread pretty quickly. It's kind of like a strawberry plant, you know how they send out these little runners and then like another thing kind of pops up? Alright, next up, 135. It's a waving hand anthelia. So this type of coral grows very, very large, grows very fast. So fair warning, they can take over an aquarium. They're excellent for beginners because they're so tolerant of conditions, but they can run rampant in a hurry. And it's not just one of those things that, oh, it makes a little creeping mat and, oh, it's going crazy covering rock. This thing can literally fill up all the water in your tank. Are green clove polyps rare? I've never seen them. Probably not really rare. The only issue that with clove polyps is that they actually ship poorly from overseas. So oftentimes when importers get them, they always die. But once they're established, they do pretty well. All right, next up, Kenya tree. This is another leather that can kind of go crazy on you. They drop little babies all over the place, but they're very hardy. So if you're not sure if you can keep coral alive, try this first. And if you don't succeed with this, you might have to change a whole bunch of stuff because you really shouldn't be killing Kenya tree leathers. They're really, really tough. Actually, I like the way it looks, but you can back up if you want. I kind of like the up-close look. All right, next up, 137, is a pulsing zinnia. So this, a lot of times people call it a weed also. And in certain places, you know, people are just trying to get rid of it. It's easily one of our best sellers, period, end of story. And I think that if you don't have easy access to this type of coral, I can see why it's very enticing. It's one of the few corals that actually has its own movement. And for like all winter long, they tend to like not pulse. But as it gets warmer and warmer and brighter, they start to pulse more more frequently. So they've kind of like regained their pulse action. All right, next up, 138. It's a tiny little neon green Nephthia. This guy's probably an inch. It's a little bit dark, Michael. Just a little dark. And they can grow substantially tall. The largest one I've ever seen was probably like 3 feet long. Okay, next up is another neon green Nephthia. Number 139. A little bit smaller. No, propagating zinnia is really easy, betta fish. You pretty much just have to cut it and just attach it to something. Really, really easy to propagate. Okay, next up, 140. Is the balloon-centered green star polyp. These things grow quickly as well. They have a nice little purple base. But sometimes algae can grow on them, so they tend to do better in higher flow. Sky High, no, we don't have any clams in this live sale. In fact, it's difficult for us to get clams, period. Like, a lot of places don't have them right now. But I am setting up a tank, and I think that, like, plan A is to try a bunch of clams. But we'll see. There's some challenges, because we don't do clams here very well. Like, they die pretty often. It's not that pleasant. But a lot of it has to do with, like, the way we do maintenance and stuff, and different types of issues. So I am looking to make a dedicated clam system. In my latest YouTube video, I did just a little quick walk around, and I showed this brand new glass aquarium that we happened to stumble upon. And I'm thinking about making that entire thing like a clam system with halides and everything. 141. So hopefully the next time anybody asks, I'll have it. 141 is another type of green star polyp, but it doesn't have those balloon centers. Did I miss mushrooms? No, not yet. Deep blue. Okay. You know what? Give me one sec. I am going to grab some drink. Some water this time. Okay, I'm back. And of course I can't use my left arm. Pathetic. This is a tiny little toadstool leather. He's probably no more than 3/4 inch. But what is kind of neat about this particular variety is that it has extremely long tentacles. You can kind of see the length of the tentacle in relation to its body. As they grow, and toadstool leathers, if you've never seen a large, fully grown one, they're massive. So it's entirely possible that this thing one day can be 2 feet across with like 4 or 5 inch tentacles sticking out. And by the way, I am drinking RODI water. This is RODI. And I got into like an argument with Robbie about that. Cause I also have heard like how you're not supposed to drink this. But I've looked online trying to find any actual research article that says specifically why you're not supposed to, and I haven't found any study on the matter. I've only heard the old wives' tale that you're not supposed to drink it. So, some context, I've been drinking RODI water for a decade. Seriously, like for at least 10 years. And yeah, it's fine. Dentist visits went fine. So, yeah. I don't know. I don't know where people hear that stuff. All right. Next up, 143. Let's go. It's a reverse Superman Rhodactis. We actually have a few of these, so if you like them, you're going to get a couple shots at it. Kind of has a blue base and red. They're not tentacles. What are they called? Vesicles? Is that what those are on mushrooms? This is a blue marbled. It says Rhodactis, it's not a Rhodactis, so let me change that. It's actually a Discosoma. There we go. Discosoma. So Discosomas tend to have like a smooth surface rather than like the hairy rough surface of a Rhodactis. That's what I tried to tell him. Yeah, except you didn't link it with an article in a journal, in like a scientific researched, not something you heard on a message board. Not on ReCentral. It's not good enough. All right, 145. Oh, burn. Not science. 145. This is a purple redactus. All right, moving on. 146. It's like a bright green redactus. We're actually making pretty good time. It's only 4:30 right now. So we've been on for about 2.5 hours, and we've got a little less than 50 corals left. Making pretty good time. And we're gonna blow through the last several of these corals because they don't even have names because they're like all different types of zoas. I don't know what they are. I just know that they're inexpensive. So yeah, we're gonna accelerate towards the finish line. Yeah, so yeah, if you have a journal article, send it to me. Send it to and I'll write an entire blog post on it. I don't believe you. All right, 147. This is the second reverse Superman we have. It's slightly different coloration, but the color scheme is the same. Yeah, for all those people that like random zoas, we have like an entire system that's just chock full of them. And I mean, I'd be willing to sell those in massive bulk for cheap, just because we just need to make room. Is this even really food? Like, I don't eat a lot of candy and stuff, right? But so this is an orange slice. Okay. Yeah, okay. We'll go to 148, then it's story time, okay? 148. So 148 is a blue marble discosoma. So I came across like a video of Walmart. It's like Crown brand or something like that, but it's basically a Walmart ice cream sandwich that doesn't melt. And this person had taken this ice cream sandwich, and he lives in California, and he sets it outside, and it's like an 80 degree sunny day in California, and he sets it outside, and like 90 minutes later, it hasn't started melting yet. And he puts like a little dollop of like real ice cream right next to it, and in like 2 minutes, that's all melted. It's a puddle. But that Walmart ice cream sandwich hasn't melted yet. And it was there for like, I don't even know how long, but it just simply didn't melt. After an incredibly long period of time. Then I found another video where this person had put that ice cream sandwich on a campfire. And it was like 4 minutes into the video where like, you know, the flames are hitting this ice cream sandwich and it's not melting. And it took like, I think it took like 5 to 10 minutes for it to finally melt down into the fire. But like clearly whatever the heck that is, it's not ice cream. I'm not even sure that's food. Like, and so that's what I think of when I see stuff like this. Like, what is this exactly? It's really awfully bright. Yeah, I bet this doesn't like melt or catches fire or whatever either. I don't know, we'll see. All right, next up, 149. It's a third Superman redactus or reverse Superman. GMO ice cream sandwiches. Yeah, that's not ice cream. I don't even know if it's gelatin. I thought gelatin burned. Oh, this is gelatin. I thought you meant like the campfire resistant ice cream sandwich. Yeah, it's real gross. Nope, we're not doing that. Nope. They tried to make it even taste like the rind. You know, you get the orange rind. That's so nasty. All right, next up. Boy, that's really gross. It's a yellow skirt rhodactress. So this guy here has a bright neon green face, but in full actinic, which you probably can't even see because of the lighting that we're using, it'll have like a fluorescent yellow rim. It's a really cool mushroom. Nathan, why didn't anyone tell me there's a live sale going on? Such a troll, Nathan. You knew. All right. 151. Purple Ricordia Yuma. These are pretty much the only types of mushrooms that can be a little bit challenging. They tend to be a bit sensitive, so kind of have to look out for that. But there's been plenty of people that have had plenty of success with Ricordia Yuma, but I'm just going to throw that out there. It might not be as beginner-friendly as some of the other mushrooms. And Nathan, I don't know if you saw the bounce mushroom video that we did recently, but there's a lot of hate out there for your bounce mushroom. All right, next up, 152. It's a larger orange Ricordia Yuma. And 153 is a neon orange discosoma. So hit that with the flashlight and see if that one lights up. Because when you look at it under like full LED at night, this thing is just like safety cone orange glowing back at you. Lothario Bow. I can't keep mushrooms for the life of me. What I think tends to help with mushrooms is a lot lower flow, like really, really low flow, and that helps them extend, and lower light. So a couple of our mushroom tanks that seems to do very well has like extremely dim blue LEDs and stuff. That's all that's going on there, and we get like huge extension and everything out of those. All right, next up, 154. It's a blue spotted discosoma. Has a red base, blue spots. This is the white striped discosoma. Can have like a reddish purple base, but then has like these white like rays kind of like coming out from the middle. Yeah, sea urchins can mess with a whole bunch of stuff. They kind of bulldoze, and who knows what they're actually going to be eating. And 156 is the only Florida Ricordia that we have. For whatever reason, we haven't seen a lot of really nice Florida Ricordia lately. This was like years and years and years ago, but we got this offer to purchase some Ricordia from Florida. And when we got it, it was like the most amazingly bright colors and everything, like super healthy. It was awesome stuff. And then a couple months after that, I got a call from like a fish and wildlife investigator. I guess all those were like poached from a national park, and they were like doing a sting operation on that particular collector. So luckily I didn't buy that much or anything like that. It wasn't a big deal. So they were just curious as to like, you know, how much stuff I actually got, whatever. But yeah, it was like the best stuff ever. Too bad. Too bad it's all illegal. 157. Yep, it'll take a while because we're going to switch tanks. But it's going to be an orange ball pseudocornactus. Becky Ann, do you have anything we need to know about this? I don't know. If this is like the first time you've ever seen this, I'll throw up the rules real fast. So, yeah, the way that this works, basically, if you wanted to purchase, this is U.S. only. I'm going to go ahead and assume that you're in the United States. Big assumption, because there's a huge international following today. But you can watch this thing on YouTube. But to purchase stuff, you have to go to TidalGardens.com, and there's like a live sale section. So you see all these corals, they're numbered, and you can like just basically take that number, put it into your shopping cart, and check out just like any regular coral, and you can mix and match. The shipping is a $39.99 flat rate, or it's $250, or it's free if your total is over $250. And in order to actually get a coral, you have to check out with it. So if you have to check out multiple times, that's acceptable. Just make sure you don't pay shipping each time by selecting as the shipping option local pickup / live sale. And when you're all done with shopping, just make sure that you've either paid shipping once for an order total less than $250, or you're taken care of if it's over $250. So long story short, that's kind of how a live sale works. Other than that, we're just really just kind of hanging out, talking about coral and movies and whatever else. RODI drinking water, that sort of thing. What number are we on? 157. Yes, there we go. Okay, so what you're looking at here is a very curious mushroom. So this actually is a corallomorph, and it's kind of needs its own special tank, because it's a very, very, very capable predator. They're well known to eat pretty much anything that it can grab onto, and it can grab onto a lot of stuff, it turns out. They're extremely sticky and can wrestle fish down and into its mouth. And when they get larger, they can wrestle tangs and like large fish down into their mouth. They get to be pizza-sized, about like 12 inches in diameter, once they get really, really big. But it is definitely a cool curiosity. And I like them. We have them kind of in a refugium / macroalgae tank. Okay, let's see. Warm or cold water? I'm going to assume that you're talking about the corals. Corals are tropical, so all of this stuff is like in 77 degree water. Let's see, number 158. It's an orange redactus. Thanks, Eric Jeffries. And Alex, talk about our plating Montes right around like the 110-ish range. But yeah, we only had like a few, like maybe 5-ish. All right, next up, 159 is a green Galaxia. Very easy to keep, stony coral. However, they are very aggressive with stinging other stuff. So they can extend long sweeper tentacles up to like 12 inches in some cases. So you kind of have to give them their own little space with plenty of room around it. Otherwise, they can get a kind of sweepy and fighty with other stuff. So have to be watchful of that. All right, next up, 160. All right, we're finally down this last stretch of zoas here. All right, so we've got some eagle eyes. So if you're looking for like cheap zoas, there's some good options here. All right, next up, pink and golds. Next is Agent Orange, 162. All right, let's go to 163. These are pink plasmas. This is a little bit tough to see. Is it possible to get a little bit closer, Michael? Yeah. Sure, because I really do like this particular variety. It's got like a speckled like pink and purple face. It's got like green highlights on its tentacles, things like that. Taylor Swift is popular. I couldn't name you three of her songs, though. Three songs of Taylor Swift. No. I'm not even gonna try. Alright. So anyway, those are the pink plasmas. I like them a lot. Next up, 164. These are Fiji Bam Bam Zoas. Were there Bam Bams on the live sale that I missed? They're here now. Okay, moving on. 165. These are some Oreo Zoas. So, I don't know how many people were here the first time we had a set of Zoas, but it was getting so much wacky lighting that it looked nothing like what you're seeing here. And that just shows you like what a difference lighting makes. These two corals are probably grown in the same place, but it just happens to be in two different tanks, shot at two different times. Under, believe it or not, basically the same type of lighting, but just because of the sun and stuff, you're getting a completely different appearance. So I think the previous Zoas were in like the 70-ish range, maybe? No. Yeah, first ones are probably 30s to 40s. So go back like later on and check like the 30s to 40s for the Oreo Zoa and the 165 here for the Oreo Zoa, and you can see exactly how much how inconsistent it can be even amongst this type of setup. Okay. Next up, 166. Mango Zoas. Have that bright mango yellow center. Okay, 167. There's some radioactive dragon eye Zoas and like some other stuff mixed in there. Not really sure what those other guys are. Okay, next up, 168. A slightly larger colony of dragon eyes. $169. Finley Nicholas, best lighting for SPS, 400 watt metal halides are the best lighting for SPS. I say that unequivocally. All right, let's see. Going to 170, some blow pop Zoas. $171 are Pink Panther Zoas. $179. That little fan pic from a few years ago, I think was literally last year. What? Okay. 172 in a second. So there's 205 corals total, and we're just blowing through the remainder of the zoas. What kind of lights, color temp are these pics under? Don't know what color temp, because the camera's probably on auto, but the lighting, it's a combination of Aqua Blue Special and Blue Plus ATI T5s. Yeah, and the camera's probably calibrated to 10,000K. We're on 172 now, I think. I'm like looking around for something to eat, but I can't eat this candy anymore. Oh, there's sweetest fish? Oh, I didn't see the sweetest fish. Never mind. Sugar's back on the menu, boys. All right, Jim S. Water Fish. For Alaska shipping, do I click the $39.99 and the $20 extra? Yeah, unfortunately, shipping to Alaska is $20 extra. So yeah, you do need both of those things. Just like Puerto Rico needs $39.99 and $20. Or if you wanted it shipped out on Friday for delivery Saturday, that's an additional $15, stuff like that. So just, yeah. Those additional shipping modules are on top of the regular shipping. Now, if you're over 250, it would be like the $39.99 portion would be free, but then you have to tack on that $20 extra. Okay. Okay, so those are the orchid zoas. Next up, we've got some button polyp. So these are actually polyethylas. And I had mentioned that a lot of people like to lump kind of like these large polyped zoas as pallies, kind of to differentiate them from the smaller zoas. But this is a pally, and it's pretty distinct. Dan, don't forget to send me some reinforcement troops in Clash of Clans. Yeah, I'll get right on that. Nathan and I are in the same clan in Clash of Clans. Ironically, okay, I don't know if you guys know this, but Clash of Clans, it's like a phone game, right? Now that like I'm old and busy, I can't play like real games, so I have to play iPhone games. But our clan is actually a British clan. We joined a UK clan. So anyway, moving on. 174. Some Jack Frost pallies. If you hit these guys with a lot of light, they get even more white colored. Next up, 175. Possibly a slightly larger Jack Frost pally. Super easy to take care of. And I'm sure that my personal trainer is like really unhappy about the whole prospect of me just chowing down on candy for 4 hours. Quibbly, man, I used to grind Clash of Clans, got to a fully upgraded Town Hall 8. I'm almost at a fully upgraded Town Hall 9. It's a totally silly grind. And then, so, okay, here's the thing about Clash of Clans. They just make you do an upgrade and wait, like, you know, a week or something like that. But you can pay money to get that process going faster. So, this game is actually really, really, really popular in the Middle East, because you have like these Saudi Arabian guys or like people in Qatar or wherever, and they're willing just to throw down money to get a, like a fully upgraded base. So this is a free-to-play game, okay? So you can just wait the time that it takes to actually play it out and upgrade your stuff, right? Or you can pay it up front and get it right away. If you pay it right away, and you start from scratch, and you pay all the way to a max base, I think it's like $200,000. But there's oil money over there, so they don't care. They want their upgraded base right now, so they just dropped down 200 grand. So this silly like little iPhone game, I think that particular company makes like $5 to $10 million a day on a free-to-play game. It's crazy. All right, anyway, there's your gaming news for the day right there. 176. Say what? I can stream Clash of Clans on Twitch. You can watch me wait for something for get done for a week. All right. 176. These are some mangozoas. Okay, 177. These are some Leonardo zoas. Yeah, Supercell makes a lot of money. A lot of money. And Leonardo zoanthids, by the way, look pretty amazing right now. Like I said, we're in peak color, so I'm kind of liking how stuff looks. Okay, next up, 178. Some double rainbow zoas. Next up, 179. Have some smurfettes. These guys are pretty interesting because it's really rare to find something that's actually blue. A lot of times, you know, stuff gets described as blue, but when you look at it, it's never really that blue. These zoas are actually blue. All right, next up, number 180. Some green spot zoas. Hearthstone. I used to play Hearthstone, and then Blizzard froze my account, and I never went and bothered to contact Blizzard tech support. I just said, yeah, I don't really need to play. So I stopped playing Hearthstone altogether. Last question is, 250 before tax or after? You're in Alaska, right? You shouldn't be getting taxed at all. It's only for Ohio, so tax is only an Ohio thing. Yeah. Except for the 20. So if your total is at 250, the $39.99 part is waived, but you do need to add the $20 shipping module for just the Alaska portion. Hopefully that answers it. Okay. All right, next up, let's go to 181. These are lavender lime zoas. Unfortunately, the bottom one isn't cooperating, so you have to kind of just pay attention to the top one. It's a pretty stunning piece. These guys, I hope to grow them out. They're one of the newer additions, so they haven't been here very long. I got taxed too in PA. Huh. You shouldn't have. Let me look into that. For all those people that did get sales tax charged, don't worry about that. I'll be refunding. I'm wondering if like something changed on the site. It's possible. You know, I can just send a text message to somebody real quick. Can you check to see what the sales tax setting on the site is? ? People outside OH are saying they are getting taxed. All right, I'll have to refund some sales tax. So anyway, don't worry about that, you guys. Sorry about that. Okay, next up, 182. Here's some cotton candy Zoas. That's really weird that some of you guys are getting taxed and some of you aren't. Because I'm like looking at other orders, and like other orders aren't getting taxed. That is going to be really interesting. All right, I'll look into it. So anyway, moving on, 183. Some double rainbow Zoas. I'm like super curious about this now. Eric, New York. Okay, so Eric, so I'm seeing an Eric from New York, but you didn't get charged tax according to what I'm seeing. So I'm wondering if it's just like displaying, it might just be displaying a tax, but, and also like Jeff Cunningham, let me see here. Yeah, Jeff, no, you're not actually not getting charged tax. So I don't know what it, like, I can't you know, obviously see when what you're seeing when you're checking out, but it, I think it might just be displaying a tax, but once you're actually, like, look at your order confirmation, and what I'm seeing is no tax. Yeah, exactly, Greg, or Jeff, I'm sorry. I pay tax on the live sale, but my invoice email says no tax charge. So, yeah, there we go. All right, because I was like, why are these like out-of-state people getting charged tax? That's so weird. Anyway, I'm still going to look into that. I don't know why it's showing up tax before that step. This is what happens when you have a free website, guys. You get funny little artifacts, and you're like, oh, I don't know how to fix that. Okay, next up, 184. Well, thanks for pointing it out, because that's important, that, you know, just to not be too confusing. Right, 184, these are some rainbow Zoas. Good, all right, so you guys are not getting charged tax, good. Makes it one step easier for me. All right, next up, 185. And Robbie, can you crack this door open, please? It's getting like roasty toasty again. All right, 186. Needs to be a little bit brighter there.
Yeah.
Some cotton candy Zoas. Yeah, it's like everybody in chat's like freaking out, like, I got charged tax. Sort of false alarms. I mean, something's definitely kind of weird. But I'm glad that you guys weren't actually charged. 187. Some green people eaters. To be perfectly honest, I'm surprised that all of these things have names, because there's going to be a whole bunch of question marks later on. All right. 188. These are some Rastas. And there's a little pipe fish. Behind one of the plugs there. 189. Let's go to the next one. Some Agent Orange Zoas. Okay. Which is a shame, because there's like a little pipe fish right there.
Yeah.
Okay, so the shade is the site is showing tax until the zip code / address is entered. Then it recalculates the total. That makes sense. Are you still using AI Vega colors in your greenhouse? Yeah, but they're breaking one at a time by at this point. All right. Oh, fish is gone. So those are the Agent Oranges. Okay, having trouble on the site not taking my gift card. Okay. Is it a gift card or is it a coupon code? Because there's two things. So if you got a coupon code, because like every package we send out has a coupon code for like a cash discount on the next order. There's a place to put that right towards like the beginning of the checkout process. Later on, if it's an actual gift card, like somebody had purchased a gift card for you, there's a little checkbox for gift card a little bit after that step. And you have to punch in the gift card in a field that pops up after you hit this little checkbox. I know it's goofy, but gift cards and coupon codes are different. So make sure that A, you're entering it in the right field. And then number two, make sure that it's not a typo on your end. Like is it like a lowercase L or is it a capital I, that sort of thing, or a number one. So like I've seen just some stuff. If you're still having problems, email me and I'll see what I can find. All right, let's move on to number 90. Again, it's like you get these weird little artifacts when you have to plug in a whole bunch of different modules into a free website. Like, it's like, I can't do a single gift card code thing. It has to be a coupon code or a gift card. Weird. Okay. Looks like he's found it. Good job, Jim. Dude, are you eating a lot of sugar? Going to the gym later? Dude, you're late. I'm super sore from the last time I went to the gym. Because I did like a whole bunch of reps with low weight. And now I can't move my arms. Alright, number 191. Some supernova zoas. Yeah, you're right. I shouldn't be eating this many Swedish fish and stuff. It's bad. All right. Let's see. 192. These are some Aussie microzoas. These are super duper tiny compared to the other ones.
Getting in that cardio workout. Yeah.
My cardio, I have gerbil level cardio right now. I'll just look at the wheel and like say, it's too much. All right, 193. Some purple death polythoas. How are you standing the frag discs up? Practice, I guess. They're actually on their side. Sorta. There's like little divots in the plate that they're on. All right, next up, 194. These are some gold flake zoas. Okay, next up, 195. We have a few of these listed. I think we just grabbed a whole bunch of the zoas like towards the end of the show. All right, and here's the point where we just kind of mail it in. 196. I don't know what these are, but we've got at least 10 of them. So if you like them, buy them up. There you go. Yeah, make up your own name. All right, next up, 197. More, Shrugs. But there's 10 of them. I'm guaranteed I can find 10 of them. Alright, next up, 198. Oh look, we actually knew the name of this one. Sorta. Alright, 199. Okay. Going on, 200. I got nothing. If you guys know what the names of these things are, by all means, toss it into YouTube comments at some point. Like, hey, number 200 is called a blank. I have no idea what these are. I've forgotten so many names of Zoas, it's not even funny. Like, I don't even try anymore. Clearly. Clearly, I don't try anymore. 201. Same sort of mystery. These are kryptonites. Are they? Those look like Leonardo's. Or they could be kryptonites. Alright, next up, 203. Almost to the end, guys. Almost there. You know, we actually used to have a name for this. I forget what it was, though. Don't remember. It's $10. Alright. 204. And ready? Lastly, you know what? We almost made it before 5 o'clock, but it's 5:13 here. So 205 is a, I don't know, Zoa. But it's green, and it's $10. I have a coral that looks like a Zoa clown, but they don't have the mouths. Yeah, I don't know what that could be. So, again, thanks you guys for coming and hanging out on a Saturday afternoon like this. We're gonna try to get as many orders out on Monday as possible, but a lot of them might be shifted over to Tuesday, just because it physically takes a lot of time to package all these guys up. And we had a whole bunch of orders before the live sale that were gonna go out on Monday. So I think a lot of that might be kind of backing some of these orders up just a little bit. So, in any case, I'll do one last shout out to the Patreon fam. These guys had donated some money to get to this threshold where they actually get a nice little shout out during the live show. So thanks, Terry. Thanks, Nate. Thanks, Louise. That's Miss Saltwater Tank, by the way, if you didn't know. Her name's Louise. And Jeff. So I hope you guys enjoy the show. I hope to be making a lot more videos. So, like, one thing on Patreon is, like, I'm going to be doing a lot more, like, vlogging. Because I actually find, like, a good way to stabilize an iPhone. And so I can just, like, kind of just chat about whatever it is I'm thinking about and just, like, toss it up in, like, in a really informal blog, vlog-type stuff for the behind-the-scenes Patreon stuff. So there's that. But then I will also be doing, obviously, like the higher production value, like YouTube stuff as well, in addition to these live sales where we can hang out a little bit. So again, thanks a lot. And I hope you guys enjoy the rest of your weekend. Don't eat too much sugar like I just did. All right. See you guys.